Example.
Flash in the box or on your hand.
Are we rolling?
Welcome. Welcome to another edition of the High Spots interview series. We are here with a conversation with
smoking my eyes.
Brian Kendrick and Paul London. Guys, thanks for being here.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
I guess the logical place to start, how and where did you guys meet?
We met in California, actually. We'll try to make our way through the Indies. Paul came from Texas, but from Texas. I was from Washington, moved to Texas, and oddly enough, we fucking wound up in California with the same pursuit of making it in professional wrestling.
Yeah, it was, I think it's just like, anyone that pursues wrestling, you have to get out of your home niche for a while, you know? And so, I had been in Texas for a while, and I was familiar with Brian and his work, and I admired it, you know, not to make you feel weird, but so I was like, well, California might be the place to go. So I went out to UPW because I was under the belief that it was
opening to Japan,
a developmental
WWE.
Deal. Yeah, they had a developmental deal for a while, UPW, and I went out there, and they told me they were still under the contract, which turned out not to be true. But anyways, I went out to California, and soon enough we ended up meeting up. This is probably around 2001.
I see.
Yeah, and we just hit it off, you know, we made fun of the same things and just kind of had the same drive and, you know, like minds. And so I think we knew that we were both kind of serious about it. And there's, you know, there's an attraction there. There's friends, you know, where you're like, I want to be surrounded. And even to this day, I like to surround myself with people who I think are quality human beings that challenge themselves, they have aspirations. They're not just lugs who sit around and are just content, you know, to pick up welfare checks or whatever, like, whatever it might be. I don't know. But just people who are lazy and don't push themselves. But that's the opposite with him. And so there was an attraction there. I felt like I could really learn something from him. So he's a hell of a friend. So it's been a really good engagement. We're not engaged.
Did you find at that point you had had a lot of the same experiences coming up in Texas with around a lot of the same people, or did you not really cross paths with as many of the same people as we would think?
You know, a few of the same people. Rudy Boy was instrumental in helping us both out.
Yeah.
Rudy Boy Gonzalez, who, fuck, I mean, when I signed up for Sean's class, it was 9 to noon, Tuesday through Thursday. Rudy was there Monday through Saturday, as long as I wanted him, and I'd show up an hour and a half early, and he'd stay 3 hours late, and it's just because he likes wrestling, and this is what he can do to get back to wrestling. So, Rudy Boy was definitely our biggest connection, fuck, years later, I wind up squeaking out a TV deal. Paul gets some dark matches and knocks the fucking socks off everybody with his match with Saturn, has a match with Matt Hardy, and and they say fucking hire the guy. And and I went to Johnny, I went to Stephanie, I said I want him as my tag team partner. And
politicking, that's how it works.
Well,
no, I'm kidding.
Well, I never stroke, but I said I'm doing nothing. Please, and sure, we'll put you on the internet bullshit show. And they did. And here we are. Smoking tobacco and
yeah, I will say, if you remember the Shawn Michaels vignettes at WrestleMania 12 when he's going towards the Iron Man match, he's warming up and working out in San Antonio with like those all those Mexican luchador guys. Rudy, we call him Bumblebee, he's the one wearing the yellow and black stripes.
He says it's not him. He insists it's not him. It's him.
Sure. Well, he was really instrumental in training me as well, because I trained at Ivan Putski's school. He's who broke me originally, Ivan Putski. And, you know, he's just a big strong man. His gimmick. Popping basketball. You know, he used to put a basketball here and he'd squeeze his bicep and he would pop the basketball.
Legitimately?
Yeah. He would break
wrestling.
Baseball bats and stuff like that. So he was a strong man, but that, I guess that limits you when it comes to psychology. So when I went to Sean's, which is the big thing, who you trained at Sean's? Like, I trained at the school that Sean ran, but Rudy was the guy doing all the physical work when I was there, and I worked with Rudy directly. He's the one that really put an idea in my head about how psychology is supposed to go.
It's a misconception. We never knew each other in Texas.
We met in California.
Yep.
Which is funny, because we live like 20 minutes from each other now in California.
And we hang out and go to movies, and comes over, my wife makes dinner, and
yeah, it's awesome.
Yeah, it's great. Yeah, funny how life works.
I
was excellent lasagna.
Oh, thank you very much. Yeah, she's a keeper.
Paul mentioned this also as far as you ending up in California, but for both of you, how critical was it to travel and to get exposure? Brian, you especially went from Washington to Texas to Memphis to Cincinnati to California. Paul also went all over the country. How crucial was that to getting your name out and getting exposure?
I guess the my biggest travel story claim to fame would be there's this dude, Mikey Henderson, supposed to go to 01.
Great look.
Yeah, he's about our height, maybe even a little shorter, but Jack, real talented, but had a wife and kids, and it was not too long after 9/11, World War III. Fuck, I ain't afraid of it. I'll take the booking, man, but I was living in Cincinnati. I moved out there from California to learn from Benoit, who was coming back from his neck surgery. But I'd spent time in California trying to get to Japan. Mikey said, you want to take the booking? They talked to the office, and I had to be out there to wrestle 3 matches in like 40 fucking hours. So I bought myself some protein, some gallons of water, took protein to stay awake, would jerk off to stay awake, and eventually at like the 30-hour mark, I started to make myself puke to stay awake. Got to a friend's house, took a shower, wrestled 3 matches, but it got my foot in the door in Japan. Japan got me WWE, and that got me sitting here next to Paul and with you guys right now.
And that was something that always stood out to me, because when I lived in California, keep in mind, the UPW Training Center and where we ran shows was in Santa Ana. I lived in Buena Park, and then I moved to Garden Grove, all within about 10, 15 miles of Santa Ana. Brian lived in Rancho Cucamonga, which is like a good 45 minutes to an hour and a half.
Yeah, at nighttime, yeah. At nighttime.
But still, it's way the fuck out there in the middle of nowhere. And he's living on his buddy's floor. This is post WWE developmental contract, right? So he'd already done more than I had at this point. So my respect for him really developed, I think, by watching how hard this person worked. I think that's what contributed to my work ethic as far as, like, boy, this guy's, you know, he was there already, and the fact, you know, and he's not, but he's not acting like he isn't. He's working his ass off because he knows he's going to be back. And, you know, and it was just, it was a pleasure for me to see him grow, but to also learn from him and to learn those techniques, like, and I knew how essential it was to travel. I knew that that was a big deal. Because I'd seen all these dipshits in Texas who were just like, I'm the fucking man in Dallas. I'm like, who gives a fuck? Nobody even knows who you are, and you still wrestle like shit. And guys just had excuses to not travel. They had excuses to not go anywhere, and they had excuses for why their careers never developed. And it was like, well, if all you have is excuses, what do you expect? You can't expect results. Oops, sorry. It's Butterfingers. And so everyone, at least my peers at the time, Lance Hoy was another guy that I started up with who eventually listened and was like, I need to get out of Texas. But he was somebody who I kept pushing, like, you need to get the fuck out of here, man, because Texas has become stagnant and it's become oversaturated, like many states have. They've become oversaturated where there's like 40 promotions and some are up for a week and then they're gone. And then, you know, and they just, you know, they put 40 kids on their match, on their shows that, you know, have never even been trained. And so the business just gets oversaturated. And so it's only wise to get out of your element, to get out of your comfort zones and travel around. And for me, it was a matter of getting to the Northeast at one point after the developmental, it turned out UPW didn't have developmental. I was like, well, I need to get to the Northeast. That's where the main exposure is. That's where apparently the biggest rated matches are at. You know, that's where the matches people are talking about. Ring of Honor, you know, even CCW at a time. I was booked for them at one point, but that fell through. But it was just, you know, these are the higher level promotions. So why wouldn't I want to go there? I don't care if I have to drive 30 hours for no money. I mean, traveling is essential. They're not going to come to you. You know what I mean? Like,
They're not going to come to you. And really, I don't know if we're really actually moving. You know what I mean? It's either me sitting on the couch for 30 hours or me doing this for 30 hours. But I'm fucking staying in one goddamn place. My feet might be moving. You know what I mean?
Cruise fucking control?
Yeah, fucking yeah. Fucking get off your ass and do it. You know what I mean? We did it. You know, we did it.
It's taking no for an answer. You're not going to take no for an answer. Because I'm sure
that's,
all you
that's
heard
what it is. Not taking no for an answer. I'll say we
Brian,
did
what
it.
Are you doing? You're too small, man. You're not going to make it. What are you fucking doing? You're going to get broken in half. You're stupid. What are you thinking, man? Pro wrestling? What do you think? No. How many no's did you get compared to the yeses? Yeah, you're going to make it. I know you're going to make it. You're going to be a big star. I know you are. How many of those did you get?
Dude, I have my mom saying, go for it.
Yeah.
And me saying, fuck everybody.
I know I did.
And that was the difference. I don't know.
No, that is the difference. Because most people don't have that. Most people think, oh, well, I'm pretty, or oh, I'm attractive, or oh, I used to be an athlete, or this or that. And while a lot of those things do contribute, I really do think, and growing up, you know, my tastes changed as far as who I admired for different reasons as I became more aware of the wrestling business and kind of smartened up to it a little bit. I specifically remember reading a Rob Van Dam interview in a Pro Wrestling Illustrated, and he said, I always knew that I would make it. I always had that belief in myself, and it was key. And I thought, I was like, well, I've always pictured myself being there. I've always believed I could make it. There's no reason. And I look and I'm like, I'm taller than some of these guys, you know? And it was just not taking no for an answer. You know, just having that drive and not settling. Too many people settle. They get successful in their town, and that's good enough. And maybe that's good enough for them, and I feel good for them. Good for them. Happy. Great. My aspirations are higher. I mean, that's just the way it is. I don't see the point in getting into wrestling if your goal isn't to make it to one of the top companies. It's just like, I want to get into the NBA just because I want to say I'm an NBA player. No, I want to get into the NBA because I want to win an NBA championship. Why not shoot for the top, right?
And I don't want to come off like we've... I mean,
I'm not saying...
I've got a lot left that I want to accomplish. I'm not saying that. But if you're saying what's the difference between making it from the indies in one state to the next level, it is going out there and chasing it and saying, yeah, I can do this. And it's confidence, that's all the difference, yeah.
It's knowing the confidence creates you're your own product. If you know you've got the goods and you know you put in the work and you're continuing to put in the work and you're just continuing to evolve and get better and better and you have that drive, you can't lose in anything you do in life. I think that most people lack confidence in this world, to be honest with you. And that's what creates a lot of arguments and fear and divorce and all sorts of problems. It's just lack of confidence, insecurity, you know?
What you got for us?
It's funny, I went from travel to insecurity. You guys
know,
travel for
yeah, you know,
insecure.
Where's Lee, by the way? That motherfucker.
Yeah, you're battling.
We talked about the travel.
Uh-huh.
Talk a little bit about experiences in Japan and internationally.
Well, I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt you for a second, but I didn't actually get to hit on this when we traveled. And I saw something. I mean, I knew that he was traveling from L.A. to Cincinnati. He drove from L.A. to Cincinnati just because he had an opportunity to try out for a company that might get him to Japan. It wasn't a guarantee. It wasn't a, hey, come sign this paper. It was just an opportunity. He drove from L.A. to Cincinnati like that. Okay, I'll do it tomorrow. It was like on a drop of... It was pretty short notice,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Who's going to do that? No one's going to do that most of the time anyways with like 3 months advance notice. But on last second, no way. But he did it and it was like, fuck. It was just another example. It was like, that's a sacrifice. Sacrifice. And so when I was thinking about it, we were in San Antonio, you know, we were driving from San Antonio to Philadelphia. It's like a 60-hour round trip. Rudy, again, sticking out for his guys, looking out for his guys that he trained and that he believed in, was like, hey, guys, I'm going to rent this van. Let's hop in the van. We're going to go up to this company.
Got the guys booked on
Ring of
Honor.
This new company, Ring of Honor, is starting up. And we think they're going to do pretty big things. It's kind of like, not so much, it's some of the guys that worked with ECW, and there's someone with an influence there. It wasn't like, hey, this is the next ECW. It wasn't anything like that. I think some people thought that, but it was something new, and it was a new opportunity. And so Rudy wanted his guys to be a part of it, to the point where he said, hey, we're going to rent a van. You guys pitch in what you can.
Really?
We worked up one more. And And we pitched in, and we took turns driving, except for Fast Eddie, because he's legally blind. I think it could work, though, fucking bastard. And we drove up to Philadelphia, and we're Ring of Honor, and we're making, you know, no money. And we were losing money. And I was in school full-time, so I was skipping class. Do you want to try? Brave man. Damn it. So, you know, it's sacrifice. It's making not, it was more important than school, so the drive worked
like
out.
It, though. It never felt like it to me.
About?
It never felt like, oh, 3 hours
straight. It didn't
feel
like a sacrifice.
It never did.
No, it felt like, fuck, let's get there.
Let's show these people
what we can do.
I'm going here.
Imagine the possibilities that could come out of this.
Never did.
You know?
It's uphill both ways. You know, oh, fuck that. It's sitting in the
car. What
are
they gonna get us? What's in it for us?
It's not that hard. It's just, you know, you just gotta do it. And if you like it, it's
if you
really,
love it,
it's really
it's
easy.
A pleasure. Mm-hmm. Had some of the best times of my life just being on the road with friends, you know? Had nothing to do with the actual wrestling itself. That was just another bonus, you know? That enjoyment of the match, but you know, guys bitch and moan about being on the road, but I found some of my most enjoyable moments in my life being on the road, you know, so it's camaraderie, it's a lot of things.
Any in particular that come to mind thinking about them? Road stories from driving to Ring of Honor or driving wherever, trying to catch a break?
Well, I mean, like, for example, we were in San Antonio. Rudy drove up to Austin because I had driven to San Antonio, my transmission blew out. So I was like, fuck, what is this, like a sign? Am I not supposed to get to San Antonio? We're already late. There's green fluid all over my windshield. And I was like, fuck, I had to get my car towed. I was like halfway, I was in San Marcos. He drove up out of the way, because they were gonna go a different way. He drove out of the way to come pick me up at a Bill Miller's barbecue. And then we went and caught him. We tried to make up time. He drove fast as shit. So he made up time. And then we drove up through Nashville, because we were picking up Michael Shane, who was living at like Tracy's mother's house at the time. And then we went from Nashville up to Cincinnati to pick Brian up. And it was just like this curvature thing. And Brian was staying, I think, at Lance's place. And so, you know, all just trying to make it. And then we made our way over to, I think, Philly.
Yeah.
Philadelphia. And, you know, we had separate matches and whatnot. But it was just, you know, it was like... And that just shows another thing as far as, like, Rudy was willing to do. That's not a direct to Philly. What the fuck, you know? So, but that's... He knew the guys wanted it. And the guys, you know...
That sounds like fun, though, doesn't it?
Fuck yeah,
it sounds like fun.
I'd do it again.
I mean, none of us were going to starve to death. None of us were going to freeze to death. We're all going to be okay.
We're all in it together.
We're all going to be okay. Yeah, we're all in it together. And we're going to go on an adventure. It beats watching reruns. You know what I mean? And I love Seinfeld, and I've seen all the episodes 100 times. But
really,
since I've seen them. Yeah, I've seen 101 though. Man, let's go on an adventure. Yeah.
I mean, travel's such a perk.
It's the best part of life. Yeah.
Of wrestling, it's such a perk. And if you know you don't have that mindset, because I mean, it's just you gotta. I don't know. I love traveling. I took geography, a lot of geography classes too.
I like maps. I know you got maps, I know.
Yeah, it helps. Terry Funk taught me that.
Dude, there's these maps, right?
Topographic maps?
No. Of the land where that would be covered with the snow in Antarctica. Dude, anyways, I'm been drinking. But
I understand.
What I'm saying is, if you like maps, I gotta show you these fucking old maps of where Atlantis was. It's fucking covered by snow. It's Antarctica, is what I'm telling you. Maps.
But it's current day? Or
it's current. No. This is maps from a few hundred years ago. But it was still covered in fucking snow. I'll show it to you. The videos will make more sense than I do.
It sounds awesome.
It's awesome.
Atlantis
is Antarctica. Yeah.
That's where the Predator hideout was, or aliens.
I didn't know
that. The first Predator, like, on this, like, Antarctic expedition.
Because aliens fucking fly into the goddamn hole in the bottom of, you know, yeah.
They hide in ice.
Hollow Earth.
No, I mean, you can preserve specimens in ice.
Oh.
So it makes sense for them to go to Antarctica.
That makes sense, too. Okay. Anyways.
How much did you... It feels weird to go back to Ring of Honor after that.
Who the fuck was talking about Yard of Honor?
Yeah.
I mean, you can...
You say Yard of Honor?
I mean, Ring of Honor, Yard of Honor, Canada, check it out. The cheap plug for Yard of Honor.
I'm gonna
check to talk about wrestling, but you can talk about aliens.
Yeah. Hollow Earth.
And the ice.
Seriously, though.
They're out there.
The sun, I just found out recently that it's not hot. Okay, now dig this, right? Why the mountains have snow on it? When it's closer, let's say, if it's closer to the oven that
you
is the sun.
It would be melting quicker.
Sure, and there'd be snow on the bottom. But the theory is that the photons aren't hot. It's the energy created when it hits the mass. And there's more mass down low as opposed to up top where it's more of a peak. So it has less mass to interact with.
Well, but I think that also has something to do with the altitude, though. Because it's hot, the higher you go in altitude, the colder it gets.
But why does it get colder?
Because
it's closer to the sun.
Space is cold.
Why is space cold? Why would you freeze? Why would you freeze going to the sun? Because you're not a big amount of mass, man. It's the photons reacting with the mass. It's trippy, man.
What photons, though? What do we mean by photons?
Photons are just little bullets of light. Little bullets of light come from the sun, little beads.
Okay, but what about sunburn?
Yeah?
Or sweat, when you're out at the beach.
Sure.
And it's hot as fuck.
Sure. But imagine if you were laying on the beach, and now you just floated up from the beach. 100 feet up into the air. 100 feet closer, right? You'd be colder. Why? You're closer to the sun now. You're still
maybe
on the beach.
Maybe the water reflects the sunlight on it.
I'm telling you, check it out, man. It's the photons interacting with the matter. It creates this energy that creates heat. Yeah, the sun is fucking cold.
The moon is cold as fuck. We know
the
that.
The moon is a space station.
What do you mean?
What I'm saying is the moon is hollow. It just so happens that Joey Sylvia gave me my book back from months ago.
Wait a minute, I'm supposed to fight that guy tomorrow.
I swear this wasn't planned. Dark Mission, Secret History of NASA by Richard C. Hoagland.
And Mike Farah.
Yeah, dude.
It's a New York Times bestseller.
It's a New York Times bestseller. Check it out, man. It's a space station. It's hollow.
I will say, if you're ever in Los Angeles, Griffith Park Observatory is my favorite place in the world to go.
How about those the night vision goggles video I just showed you yesterday, before you came out here?
Did you?
The night vision goggles of the spaceships.
Dude, you didn't show me that.
I did.
No, I swear you didn't show me.
Oh, I showed Brett. I'm sorry, buddy, Brett. Anyways, yeah, YouTube that UFO night vision goggles.
Does it look like that?
No. That's not the UFOs.
Well, the reason I mentioned Griffith Park is because they have this giant telescope. And when I first moved out to Los Angeles about a year and a half ago, I went out there and they have this giant telescope. Griffith Park, they filmed Rebel Without a Cause there. It's a really famous landmark in Los Angeles. But anyways, it's free. And I went there and was able to check out the telescope which they had fixed on the moon. I'm only bringing this may not even be the moon, but I'm just bringing it up. I could see the craters and everything on the moon. It was phenomenal. Like, it changed my life. It had such a profound effect on my life. Like, it was incredible. Like, if a guy was on the moon waving at me, I could have seen him. That's how close this telescope was magnified on the moon. And it was just, like, I felt so lucky. You know what I mean? Like, to be a part of the galaxy. They had something so incredible part of it.
Because your soul came from the fucking moon, man. Check it out. Anyways, what do you got next?
I know there's life there.
It's awesome. Our life came from there.
Found water there.
Yeah.
Chronologically, we were in Ring of Honor before we went to outer space.
It's cold in this room. That's why we have our jackets on. Because we're flashers. We might be. I flashed a few people before.
How important to both of your careers was Ring of Honor?
What company?
No.
I'd say more important in a way on my end. Just it really helped put me on the map. Whereas I think Brian was kind of already on the map a little bit. It just really enhanced him. That's my opinion.
I had a developmental deal, but I had done shit on the indies. And that was the the first thing that got me out there was Ring of Honor.
Back out there.
Yeah, it gave me, you know, they gave me a chance. I owe a lot to Gabe. Man, I don't know. I like Gabe a lot. You know, it's fucking running a company. He's fucking driving him. It seems crazy. I don't know, but he's always been real good to me. And yeah, he helped him and Hashimoto in 01. I think really gave me my two biggest breaks for sure.
Yeah, I think it was. I actually went up there as a standby, but then I think, if I remember correctly, a week or something before the show, the guy fell out, and so I became the actual guy in the match. My first recollection is just going up there, doing this like 30-hour trip up to Philadelphia, and being really amped for it. And be like, oh, you know, we have this great opportunity to show this whole other kind of fan base what we can do, and hopefully, you know, kind of get our names out there a bit more. And then, you know, we had this tag match. I had this stupid Asai moonsault idea, and so the match was over in like 3 minutes because I, you know, this guy's Chris Marvel ended up catching me, and his ankle snapped in half, like a clean break. It was a freak accident. It was just so amped to get up there, you know what I mean? And then 3 minutes and it's done. And I was just, it was like shock. And I felt so horrible that I'd hurt my friend. Even though, you know, it was a fucking accident, you know? I mean, it's a risk. It's a high risk sport when you're doing all this shit. And it was a simple oscillating moonsault. He just happened to have his feet planted wrong, I guess, or in a weird position. But they cut off his kick pads and it was weird. It was a weird, but I was tripping out. And I was just like, I felt just like, it was just bad. But, you know, a couple guys, a lot of guys actually in the locker room were actually real supportive. And they're like, don't let it get you down. It could happen to anybody. And so I remember that too, that was one of the first experiences I'd had in the locker room that was really supportive and like felt somewhat like a family. You know, you hear that a lot about, oh, this locker room is a family, and that word gets tossed around so much. And we heard that word a lot when we were working for the entertainers, and you know, we're family, guys, gotta look out for each other. Like, are you fucking kidding me?
No, it's all a line of shit.
Bunch of bullshit.
Anywhere you go, like I said, I mean, I owe a lot to Gabe, but then, you know, his company's been involved with lawsuits towards wrestlers, which
Dragon Gate, currently,
which just disgusts me. And I've talked with him, and you know, it has nothing to do with anything. But fuck, families, it's a crock of shit. You know what I mean? It sounds nice, but so you're supposed to stay in this family forever? You know, in North Carolina, am I not supposed to move up to that family? If that's a fucking family from that family, it's all bullshit. You know.
That's what I'm saying. It gets tossed around so much.
Yeah.
But at the time, that was something that just felt like what I had understood a family to be in the locker room. Because guys were supportive, and everyone wanted the product to succeed. You know, everyone's like, hey, this is all cool and upstart. And I think everyone was really excited to be a part of it, you know, except maybe Conan.
I loved it though, man. I loved it.
I did too.
I loved it.
It was the highlight for me. And like I said, I was in college full time, so I was like missing half a week of school at a time. I'll tell you what my grade was, but it was, you know, that was the highlight for me. It was getting up to Ring of Honor and getting to do that, you know, every month or every other month. And that eventually opened up the doors for me to go to Japan, you know, through Steve Corino and 01. And so, Ring of Honor for me put me on the map. If, you know, if there's a map and I'm on it, that's what did it. So,
what do you attribute? You talked a lot about attitude and work ethic and being dedicated and traveling and sacrifice.
Brad attitude.
What do you attribute to going from a standby match to being featured on the card and being one of the guys that they're really building the company around? Like, what do you think afforded you guys that opportunity?
I've never really felt like much of a featured guy.
Or a guy that the company is building around.
Yes. Yeah. To be perfectly honest with you, I felt like I've been very capable wrestler. Yeah, I can get the job done. I think I can make shitty guys look good. I think I can possibly tell a story in the ring. I don't know, but I don't think I've ever been the guy that a company's ever been focused around ever in any company. We had the tag belts, and 6 months into our tag title reign, the boss decided he didn't like our masks. He told the agents, "What are these guys doing wearing masks?" Now, mind you, we'd been wearing masks all the way up through that title reign and prior to that, but he hadn't been watching, and we were the tag champs. That's as big of a rub as I've ever gotten, and the promoter didn't know our names and didn't even know we were wearing fucking masks to the ring for over half a year. So I've never felt like a featured guy.
Well, more specifically...
I have a funny... I remember that conversation with the masks. Because...
My wife made those masks, so it killed me. Yeah.
And we took a lot of pride in them. Because they were different. We tried to make them different each time. But I remember Johnny... What's that again? Johnny Ace. Calls me... And I don't remember where I'm at, but I'm in a parking lot somewhere. And he's like, "Hey, we need to talk about the masks." Like, "What, the masks? What, you like them?" He's like, "Actually, the boss doesn't really see the point of them, and we need to lose them." I was like, "All of them?"
All of them.
I was maybe in an elevated state of mind. I was like, "All of them?" He's like, "Yes, all of them." I'm like, "All right. Sounds good."
So you've never felt like a featured guy either?
Never.
Okay,
no.
So.
Well, for instance, there's going to be a 60-minute match to determine the first Ring of Honor champion, and you're one of the four guys.
Headlining
against Samoa Joe at Death Before Dishonor, for instance.
I felt most featured at Ring of Honor, I would say. I felt pretty featured at PWG. I have felt... I feel featured at certain times in TNA. You know what I mean? Those are match by match bases, you know, obviously. But I would say, you know, as far as this guy's on our roster and we are so happy that he's a part of our roster and like that's we're lucky to have this guy. I would say Ring of Honor and PWG so far are the only two that have really made me feel that way.
So how do you think you went from a standby guy to being in that position?
What do you mean, as far like a standby guy to a standby guy?
Meaning what made you from just the jerk off that
I'm still
is expendable
off
to the guy they want to keep booking?
I think, you know, I gave really good massages, and that had some part now. That's true. I was just everywhere at the time. I was working my ass off. I was trying to get as many jobs as possible. You know, I was just trying, I was working at Old Navy, and I skipped work because I called Kevin Kelly and I said, "Hey, you guys are in Austin." I think Eddie Atlas had given me the phone number. He said, "Yeah, because I had done a dark, the first time I'd ever done a dark wasn't actually at a TV, it was at a house show in Florida through Dory Funk Jr. He was trying to promote Adam Windsor, and you know, so he had this agreement with because I guess, you know, they had an in. Dory had been a trainer at the dojo for a while before, you know, that fell through, and so he still had an in there. And so he had this agreement, I guess they had made this agreement where they were going to do house shows, like, you know, three house shows and then a TV, it's the norm. And they were in Florida, and he had those three house shows, and he had Adam Windsor on a dark for each night. He had three darks, right? But he just had a different opponent each night. And I was the guy on the third night, and the other matches were terrible. And my match was terrible, too. I mean, it was fucking horrible, but it wasn't as horrible as the other ones. And I was able to showcase some of my abilities. Even though the matches were, afterwards I realized, oh, these were all about Adam. But he kind of just exposed himself. But either way, they remembered me from that, and there was some interest there. So I called Kevin Kelly, and they were in Austin, And I was like, hey, what do you guys need? You know, whatever, I'll set up chairs. Like, just the stupid shit that you think might help you. And like, no, we're good. Don't, you know, we're good. We don't need anybody. And I was like, all right. I was like, fuck this, man. This sucks. God, some dick. I keep at it. And Old Navy called me, like, coming into work? No. And then the unavailable called, and I was like, motherfuckers, I'm not coming to work. I picked up and was like, hey, there's Paul Linden there. I was like, who's asking? Kevin Keller. Oh, yeah, it's him. Oh, you're fading the call. Like, well, I'm supposed to be at work, but I skipped. And he was like, we need you in Austin. So I was like, oh. And I zipped down to Austin and ran to the Irwin Center, and they were like, hey, we got you with Perry Saturn. I was like, bleh.
I had my tryout there too.
Awesome. You did?
Yeah,
I did. Tag, right?
Yeah,
was
yeah,
it
no
a tag?
Shit. Yeah, yeah.
So,
Frank Irwin Center. Yeah, yeah. Magical place. Yeah.
But as I think most guys will see, you know, you'll do a series of tryouts and they might need, you know, they might lead to nothing. I mean, guys feel like they get jerked around, whatever their issues are, I don't know. I was lucky enough to have several looks that seemed to escalate in value each time I had a tryout. And so that was something I think worked in my favor, that each time I had a dark or a tryout I produced, because I had tryouts in empty arenas with boys laughing and critiquing the match around, you know, and that's nerve-wracking. That's, you know, in front of 20,000 people is one thing, but in front of like all these guys you've been watching on TV and, you know, you can hear them cracking jokes about you and what, and, you know, so, but there was just a lot of like tests or whatever, you know. I think it just kept showing that, like, hey, I really want to be here. And TNA had offered me a contract at the time. And I was like, well, you know, it was like a year. And then I said, well, I'm in school. And I don't, and I said, ah, then it went to 9 months. And they're like, okay, 9 months. And then 6 months. Then 3 months. And they're like, how about 3 weeks? I was like, no, I don't know. But really, it was because I knew where I wanted to be. And I felt like I was close. And so, you know, they eventually saw that, and I was like, hey, they gave me, you know, they offered me this deal, but I don't really want to sign it because I want to be with you guys. And so I was fortunately able to use it as a little bit of leverage, and it worked, you know. And Brian was vouching for me, and so I think there was a lot of elements that went into going from just a who to, hey, let's take a look at this guy. So it's a long answer.
Did you remember the question? Not a fucking chance.
Yeah.
No fucking way you remember the
Hold
question.
Hold on. I remember the question.
You got it on paper. There's no fucking way you remember that.
Not with all your yapping.
With all my yapping. What's your next question?
What was the most jarring difference from the independent circuit to WWE?
How did you go from being a fucking regular guy to being a guy that they... Something along those lines, right?
Something like that. I'll give you that. Yeah, okay, you're right. All right. Anyway, so you're saying...
most jarring differences from the independents to WWE.
Dreams ruined. Throw on the ground.
No, I mean, on the independents, yeah, you got, you know, 15 minutes, you know, you got...
To a half hour, to an hour?
Whatever, yeah, it could be that, you know. But say your opening match, you know, throwaway, whatever, eight-man match, and you got 15 minutes in an eight-man match, and you could show some shit. Where... What's up?
Show some shit.
Thank you. To where you show up to work and you might not be needed. You know, that's the difference. You're under contract and you go to work and we got nothing for you. And you sit there and you lose your hunger because what's the fucking point? And that's the difference. I've talked to a lot of friends who since, and Paul has said it for the first 5 conversations since I got released, you sound like a different person. And he kept mentioning how much better I'd sound, or when he'd see me how much better I looked, and I felt like a different person, and I'm not gonna say it was an evil company. It just wasn't a company for me, you know. What they wanted, what I wanted, were different, and for me, the independence, I don't know. I get it.
You could breathe.
Yeah, I get that self-satisfaction. That's the difference.
I mean, we all get into wrestling I would like to think, because we love it, we really love it for the right reasons. Not because, you know, we want to be celebrities in our town or celebrities in our own mind, which is what it seems like the reason a lot of the people on TV are on TV. But now I did forget what I was going to say.
What were you just talking about? What the difference is? What's the major differences between the indies?
Yes.
And so, and contract life.
Well, you know, you give all your power away, I think, when you sign a contract. You know, it's everything is up to them. You know, when I'd worked there, apparently there's like a list of like 10 or 15 guys where everything revolves around those guys.
We found that out when we took the tour, man.
Sure.
Found that out when we took
the tour. Right, right. So, I mean, there comes a point when you have to, and it goes back to the confidence, you know what you can do, and you know what you're capable of doing, and you know that you can produce. And it's just a matter of going out there and being like, well, I'm going to produce the absolute best I can in my mask, because this is what I have control over. Mm-hmm. Your physique. I have control over my physique. Everything else you pretty much don't have control over. I remember there were times when I had a series of matches with Jimmy Yang, which a lot of people seem to enjoy. I had fun working with him just because he's a really good friend of mine, and it was easy. And we could beat the crap out of each other, and we knew it was fine. But they would just be edited all to hell. The match was like, we'd be like, you know, like 5 minutes edited out. And so, you know, stuff like that's frustrating when it's matches that you took pride in, and they get chopped up, and, you know, so that stuff you just... That's TV, apparently. But, you know, I would liken it a lot to certain situations in high school, you know what I mean? Because it's not a company for everybody. And, you know, like Brian was saying, it wasn't for him, and clearly it wasn't for me either.
No fucking way.
Clearly it wasn't for me either. And so, you know, I believe our new price tag, Vince, is a gazillion dollars. So unless you can pay that by midnight tonight, your balls, they will end up in Hunter's mouth, as they always have. Gazillion dollars.
Bearskin rug.
Ball in mouth. Ball in ball in mouth in mouth. It's like a ball seat, ball 69 in mouth kind of combination.
Elaborate on what you referenced, something you learned on the tour?
On the tour.
You said there's only 12 or 15 guys.
Oh, with a list.
And we learned that on the tour.
And I didn't mean on a tour of like an international tour. I meant we took a tour of the office. Now, mind you, it was Paul, myself, and Gene Snitsky, who I've always got along with, and I think you
yeah.
do too.
Yeah, I like Gene a lot.
I like Gene.
They were getting everyone in groups and sending them to the office to show how the company was working for us.
The way they put it doesn't sound good, but it does make sense. Like, you've got 500 motherfuckers in this office trying
tons
to make
resources.
You a star. And yeah, and it does. You know, it was an enlightening a tour as far as that goes, but it was enlightening too when you find out like Gene, hey, you know, we meet with Shane, and Gene gives him a big hug and gives him a cigar, and we're the douchebags, and the three of us.
Gene, what's up, buddy?
Hey, brother.
Oh, hey, what's up, guys? Take a seat.
And we sit down.
Gene,
and
you want a cigar?
Hey, he gives the spiel, and at this point we're about halfway, three quarters of the way through the tour, and we've seen the fucking building, and it's, you know, it's
especially
it's,
the parking lot. You're in there, you smelled it, you know what I'm talking about.
We got all the who's who's, but no tag teams. And even some legendary characters,
well,
but no tag teams.
People don't care about tag teams.
Well, that's it. I asked Shane, I said, what does a tag team have to do to be on the walls here? And he goes, guy, well, not since Legion of Doom have I cared about a single tag team. Well, shit, all right. I mean, fuck, it's...
Cool, man. Yeah. So we need spikes on our shoulders.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, and we look at the guys they have, like the 15 guys on the WrestleMania poster, and that's it. That's it. I mean, that's fine. It's a TV show.
But if you think about it, I don't want to be on any of those WrestleMania trucks anyways. I mean, they're close-ups. Remember that? We can see Maria's peach. She had like a beard.
Yeah,
it really closes up on you. I got bad skin.
It's a TV show. And that's it. And that's what I found out. We're not part of the main cast. We're the... were the
reoccurring characters.
We're not even the reoccurring.
No, we're reoccurring.
No, dude, we're the guys, like, you know, in Saved by the Bell, like, they're sitting there, and they're bullshitting at the...
We're
the ones with their backs fucking turned.
No,
but it's the same fuckers who always have their backs turned. That's us.
No, we're reoccurring.
They don't know their fucking names, man.
Reoccurring. That might even lie good with you.
Okay. Reoccurring characters.
The audience is the extras, man.
Okay.
We're the reoccurring characters.
Okay. We weren't Urkel, though.
Well, no, Urkel was over, man. Yeah. He was like, Urkel.
Who would you liken us to?
Boner.
Boner's missing. You guys know that, right?
My boner.
By the time you see him, Boner might be dead.
Boner is dead.
Did they know?
Yeah, Boner's dead.
Boner's dead?
Boner's dead.
Get the fuck out of here. Seriously?
Yeah,
that's it. Wow. I left Los Angeles. Boner was missing.
Fuck.
I'm here in North Carolina. Boner's dead. Fuck, guys, this has gotten pretty heavy pretty quick.
Yeah, this has really gotten in the gloom.
Would this be a bad time to ask about Benoit?
I will tell you.
I didn't know what his boner looked like.
I will tell you this, man.
You didn't show me.
There's some people where you just get a fucking vibe.
I like the guy, personally. I knew he was crazy, and you knew he was crazy, though, right? Yeah, we used to say he was tripolar. It was like a new form of polarity that's fucked up.
You know, honestly, nobody had been more complimentary of my work, though.
He
loved my technique, and
he'd be like, he'd have Brian showing people how to do shit when they would ask him for, hey, Chris, how do you do this? You'd be like, well, that's Brian.
It was really insane. He's a guy I looked up to professionally. But at the same time, man, people with blue eyes are crazy. I got them. He had extra blue eyes. I don't know.
I think the business drove him nuts.
You got blue eyes. You know what I'm talking about, right? We're fucked, right?
Yeah. Aryan motherfuckers.
That's it, right? Yeah. We're Nordic aliens. Yeah.
I remember specifically, I remember there was a time, we were in Zurich, Switzerland, finishing up a tour, like a European tour. To answer your Benoit stuff, early on in our career, they thought we weren't taking our jobs seriously because we were working out 10 hours a day.
He came in to me when I was showering, remember? In Nashville?
Benoit?
Yeah. Right? No, Benoit, open up the shower. Did you work out today? No, I
worked off.
Yeah, anyway. So,
yeah, it was really bizarre. But early on, Chris Benoit and Bob Holly took it upon themselves to kind of take us under their wings, their meat wings, and make sure that we were kind of on what they felt was the right path, you know, to being successful or to sustaining in that career. But
I fucking left within a month.
Yeah,
I left within a month. These guys were lunatics. I hated everything about it. They at the same time, though, I do appreciate what they did for
us.
It
was similar to, like, a Young Boys situation.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, pick them up from the airports and stuff like that, and, you know, hotels, get all that stuff straightened out, and then, you know, waking you up at, like, you know, 4:30 and getting to the gym at, like, 5 and working out.
Canceling your Bob Evans order.
That was your order.
That was my Bob Evans
order. Yeah, and just, like, you know, you would wake up, work out intensely for like 2.5 hours, eat this like insane lumberjack meal, and probably do 1,000 push-ups like all by 9 o'clock in the morning. And so I remember they had us doing that for, it felt like a couple months. You know, we were on this kind of like intense young boyish schedule. And I remember one time we went to a Bob Evans. And I think it was in Michigan or something, and it was snowing. It was just really nasty outside. Anyway, so it was, I was working out with Bob and Benoit and Jamie, mini Benoit, was with Brian. And so anyways, we all meet at Bob Evans, and we're sitting there, and Jamie is like carbon copy little...
He idolized them,
yeah.
For sure.
I think he might have come out of Benoit's ass at one point.
I like Jamie.
I do too. You know, he like the zoo, those wax sculptures that squeeze out. And so, we're at Bob Evans, and I think it was like Benoit, Jamie, Bob. I don't know why the three of them would be sitting on the same side.
To stare us down.
And then I was sitting next to Brian. We were sitting there, and they start with Benoit, and they're like, "What can we get you order?" He's like, "Steak. 20 egg whites.
Steam my steak. And
steak. You know, it was like 15 egg whites, toast, dry, tomato. Boiled
chicken breast."
And she's like, "How about you?" And Jamie back, same thing. And then Bob would order something
Give
insane.
Me twice as many.
Yeah, Bob would have like this Michael Phelps diet, like just for breakfast. And then go to me. I was like, "I don't want to get beat up. Like, this is so stupid. I'll have egg whites. Like, I just need like six of them. And I'll just take the little steak. Like, you'll take the big one. I'll take the big one." And then I was like, "Whatever." And then Brian's like, "I'll have a big stack of flapjacks and butter and syrup and whipped cream and all this shit." And
I think I had to go order some French toast. And
like retarded, like, sugar diet.
Breakfast.
And she had, like...
A breakfast.
Yeah, the lady had, like... She was taking the order, and she's like... And Benoit, like, reaches across the table.
"Give me the number 7.
He's like, "No, no. Trash, he's not ordering that. Give him what I had. No. No, he's not eating that. No. No."
"Hey, Ty, you see me, man? I can't even finish a sandwich. This motherfucker made me choke down every last pukey egg, and I ate it."
He's sitting there ordering it, and then when his order got interrupted, he's like, "No, he's not ordering that. No. Give him what I had." He was like, "Oh, I'll kill you." Like, that's what he was saying with his eyes. "I will kill you." No, he wasn't saying that. It was all work out with you.
It was a breakfast deal.
And Brian, I just see this fork and I'm, he's kind of tossed. I'm like, "Well, all right." So it was an experience, though. I valued it. You know, it was interesting. Working out with Bob was awesome in a sense, you know, other than I know what it takes to avoid a fatality from Bob, because I know that he will rip your goddamn throat out if you get to the gym before him. Okay. And if
stay longer than him.
If you stay longer than him, and if you grunt and make sounds while you work out. So now I am the shortest duration, most silent, latest I can get to the gym worker or outer you could ever see. Because I don't want to wake up with my throat torn out. Compliments of Sparky. I'm scared.
So
Operation Sandman.
Yeah, that's a great
What's
fucking
movie. What's
your
take on Operation Sandman, Paul Lund?
It's quite the cinematic flick. If y'all get a chance to check it out, Ron Perlman, who you might know as Hellboy. I think he's a crazy guy.
Haven't watched it yet.
I need to watch
it
with you.
I know. I will watch
Operation Sandman. Check it out.
Robert Howard.
Awesome.
Operation
Bob
Sandman. Howard. Amazon.com. It's like $3 on VHS.
What's a deal?
Switch things.
I stopped smuggling under my nuts a long time ago.
Yeah, we should have.
Fuck,
we
it
really
seems so easy now.
We really should have.
I look back home, I'm like, "Why? Fly Southwest.
Why didn't we do it?"
Damn it. There's no metal in that little orange container.
Brian, what were your thoughts and memories from your first stint in developmental in Memphis and some of the people that were there? You got to work with Regal, you got to work with Bobby Eaton, Tracy Smothers.
Mm-hmm. Reckless Youth.
Reckless Youth, I did. It was interesting. You know, I was 21 years old. I got sent to Memphis. I was excited about it. I didn't, you know, I was pretty naive to the whole deal. And all of a sudden came a day when Memphis was shutting down, and they told us that, okay guys, you're either getting sent to OVW or the new developmental in Ohio. And the first person goes in is Joey Abs, and he doesn't get A or B, he gets fired. And we know this is all bullshit, man.
It's a cabana.
Yeah. And we got fucking 20 other motherfuckers that have to go in there to figure out, oh, we're going to Cincinnati or Ohio, or we're getting fired. And you know, it went Shooter Schultz, bam, it went Dragon, bam, it went I, bam, fired.
Just like that. But in person, at least.
In person by Dennis Brandt, who had never seen us work. And then a week later, when I talked to him, they made a video, a highlight video to send to all Japan. And on the phone, he said, well, you're pretty talented. Well, thanks for firing me. You know, Jesus, like, get the fuck out of here.
Christ.
So that's how it works, man. Yeah.
Memories of training under Bobby Eaton and Tracy Smothers.
Tracy Smothers was awesome. Bobby Eaton was awesome. William Regal was awesome. They all had their own styles. I had no problems with any of them. It was all The Office who had problems with any of them. You know, Tracy Smothers wasn't office enough. Bobby Eaton wasn't office enough. But fuck. I mean, what I learned from them, I don't give a fuck if they're office or not. Man, they're awesome. Bobby Eaton's the man. Tracy Smothers, the man. William Regal's the fucking man. So, yeah, I mean, I learned a shitload. Whether The Office approved of it or not, man, I learned a lot.
Kind of along the same path, Paul, what were your experiences like at OVW?
I didn't really like being there. It was, I felt like I was going there to kind of appease The Office, and it was like, well, I want to keep this job. And so they were, we're going to send you to OVW, I had a friend who worked for PW, or one of the magazines, and she sent me a lot of tapes of OVW, and I kind of caught up with the roster. I had no idea who it was, and I mean, I wasn't really impressed. I think when I got there, everyone was either living in these apartments where everyone lived, or they were living at the like a condo lodge or extended stay or something. So I was like, fuck this, I don't plan on being here much longer. I'm just gonna go stay at the extended stay. And I still had an apartment in Austin, so I was doing like double rent kind of thing. And I just kept telling myself, I'm not gonna be here that long. I don't wanna get involved in storylines. I don't wanna get involved in any of this shit, because I don't like this town. I don't really care to be here. And I was only there for like 2.5-3 months, really. It was a fun little learning experience. I embraced it. I didn't despise my time there. I just really didn't plan on being there long. And so I kind of just kept myself, out of hindsight, of like, I didn't make a good point to be like, hey, Jimmy, you know, like, Jim Cornette, hey, put me in this room, like, and I think I had one TV match, and it was actually with Aaron Stevens. It was his first TV match, my first TV match, and he went up, and that was it. And then, like, a couple years later, Jim Cornette comes up to me, and he's like, God, I had no idea who you were, I had no idea, I should have done something. I was like, oh, yeah, you had your chance, like, but truthfully, I didn't want to be in their storylines because I didn't want to have to stay in Louisville living there and continuing on with storylines long after I might have been given the go home and live somewhere that I really preferred to live. And so, you know, it was an experience and I valued it. I made some friends there and I learned some things. But at the same time, I felt like their whole farm system was just training robots. It was just like, everyone do the same shit, and everyone learn the same roll-ups, and everyone do the... And it was just like watching the same fucking match over and over again. They had Rip Rogers, who wasn't putting his ass plug back in his ass. He was sitting there fucking just burying people and asking for yogurt protein bars, and if you brought him a protein bar, you could sit out of training that day. And I was like, what kind of faggots are they training here? Like, this is a bunch of bullshit. Are you kidding me? You know what I mean? They had Bob Holly come in there and just rip everyone a fucking new asshole. It was hilarious. You had Jillian Hall trying to do 450s off the fucking top rope with her gut hanging out. And that was after the day where she took the whole day off of training because she wasn't feeling good. But then came showtime. She's ready. She's up and ready and doing 450s and getting ready to work the show and stuff. And like, I remember Bob Holly had everyone. He was like, everyone come sit over here. Come sit, like, well, he didn't say it because he would have yelled, but they had everyone come sit down in the bleachers, like, right before showtime, one of these OVW shows. And it was when Jillian, like, couldn't bother doing any workouts or anything like that, but come showtime, she's ready to go. And And Bob Holly's just touring her. He's like, that fucking gun, you need to cover that shit up. And the goddamn 450, I would never lay down for that. You're fucking damn, this is horrible. And he's just like, ripping everybody.
He laid down for the moonsault, didn't
he? Yeah, poor guy. But, you know, it was my introduction to the ass-kissing phase of the business, where it was just like, how many dicks can we stick in our mouth at one time?
The vampire had posters of him up in his bathroom. Oh, he did.
Yeah. So, I made some friends. I got along with Danny Davis. The lady's really cool. Cornette was cool. Kenny Boland was really, really cool. He took care of me a lot. Took me out to eat a lot and stuff like that. And just, you know, just a good dude.
We wanted to taste your cock, man.
No, his son was a big Ring of Honor fan.
Oh, okay, that's
so they were cool. That's where I met Nathan Jones, who'll break your bones.
Yeah, he will.
And Horseshoe, and he was cool, and some of the other guys. And yeah.
Shoot, that's
it is what it was, yeah. But I'm glad it didn't last any longer.
Thoughts from both of you on Michael Shane?
Love him.
Yeah, me too.
Texted
man.
Him today and told him we're having a blast out here.
Yeah, he was a class after mine at Sean's. I really liked the guy. He stayed at my place in Florida. He stayed at my place in California. He's my buddy. Yeah.
We just recently did a show together. When I originally met Michael Shane, I didn't like him at all. We met in San Antonio.
Well, he's a dick, man.
Yeah.
That's why
if you don't know if you don't know him, if you don't know him, he might rub you the wrong way and you should be like, who the fuck is this guy? I mean, I've tried to get him booked with a few promotions and the promoters just, you know, they'll respond with, oh, Michael Shane? Yeah, I mean, I met him in a few shows a few years ago and he wasn't the nicest guy.
He's an asshole.
I'm like,
I love
him. He's solid. He's good. He probably thought you were some fucking building.
Oh, he's an asshole. We don't need excuses. He's an asshole. I love it.
But I love Michael Shane. So when I originally met him, I'd worked a match with Lance Hoyt. It was god awful because neither of us had any idea what we were doing. And I remember, you know, he had done some ECW shots at the time, like the real ECW, not the disgrace. And so I valued his opinion as being someone who had been there. I was like, hey, man, what do you think? Before I could even finish my sentence, he's like, oh, that was fucking horrible. That's the worst fucking thing I ever seen. God damn, where the fuck? You're fucking the worst. Like, just burying it. And I was like, God, this guy's a fucking ass. I fucking hate this motherfucker. I was like, who the fuck is this guy? What a pretty fucking cocksucker with his raccoon tail haircut. And I was who the fuck wears that hairstyle? I was just like, ugh. And,
sling it on over.
And he turned out, and then later when we started working in Ring of Honor, we worked each other and I had improved a lot at that point. And we had a match and I ended up putting him over and he was just the complete opposite. Oh my God. And, he was like, man, you know, and you've really improved and you just really hit it off and made good chemistry again. So we became like really, really good friends and he was staying at my place whenever he was in Texas. And we had dark matches together. We had dark matches against each other. And to this day, I never understand why they didn't hire him. Because he seemed like almost tailor-made to work for WWE, to be honest with you. I mean, motherfucker, in my opinion, throws the best punches second to Shawn Michaels that I find anywhere. I mean, I value his work, so I think he's such an incredible worker. So overrated. Maybe he doesn't have the best business.
Nah, he's a lousy piece of shit.
but I love the guy. And we just recently did a show, a double shot in Northern California in Reno, where we ended up getting pulled over and almost arrested. And we just had wild times together, man. He's a good fucking guy. I remember this other buddy of ours got shorted on some pay at this show that we just recently did in Reno. And we were already kind of hammered, and we were just like, can't believe they didn't pay you, man. It's bullshit. And we were like walking back into the hotel room, just like fucked up in the casino. And I was like, ah! I just threw this lamp down, like this lamp that was in the corner, just whatever. We were just bored. And then the lamp, it had one of those martini glass lampshades on it. And I was just like, ah! I threw the lamp down. It's like raucous, stupid wrestler shit. And I was like, oh, it didn't break, thank God. And I went to pick it up, and out of nowhere, he just goes, ah! He just shattered the whole thing. Like, did this Sean's, you know how Sean turns the face and like stomps on it? He just did that to my lamp in my room, and the whole lampshade just went, psh! And I was like, well, guess we're not putting that back, right?
And but somehow we ended up putting the lampshade back somehow, and I still to this day haven't been billed for it. So, but it became the Sean Staub.
And we had a street fight back in Ring of Honor, which kind of really helped solidify us as stupid idiots. And
his breath smells like dick.
Awful, because he dips a lot.
Yeah, and he sucks a lot of dick.
Chew dick.
Yeah.
It's like chopped up, like pump his pockets, yeah, those dip pockets.
Dip and dick.
Yeah,
dick
it's like
and dip.
Dick shavings.
Yeah, dick dip.
Yeah. I gotta take a dick. That's what this is, the slang.
Memories from both of you of wrestling in Japan.
Damn slopes.
Yeah, I liked it, man. They're fucking goofy over there. They're quick to get off a fucking airplane, I'll tell you that much.
And they smoke on buses with the windows up.
Yeah.
Yeah, the long tour buses, you'll be taking like an 8-hour bus ride from Tokyo to Sapporo.
And they prefer rapes to sex. Yeah, they like rape and...
Japan's exciting, though. When you go there, you're just like... You really are in another world. I mean, it's so bizarre.
I'll tell you what. I'm a short Irish guy, and Japanese condoms don't fit me, so I feel like a million fucking bucks. But my wife, who you know was my girlfriend at the time while I was banging out there, oh, these Japanese condoms don't fit. Let's get you some Magnums. Well, the fucking Magnums were American Magnums. Well, fuck, I'm a fucking short-dicked Irishman. The Japanese ones don't fit me, but these fucking, these, anyways, so yeah.
Baggy condom, I hate
it. Yeah, that's, yeah, Japan, yeah, thank you.
No, it's a cool place. I mean, yeah.
Hairy
bushes. They don't shave, their pubes out there. It's really bizarre. Like, I guess you'd be a hooker or in the porn industry to be acceptable at shaving. Yeah, it's a really weird place, you know, I mean, because you'll be in your hotel room. And they always put us up, 01 always put us up off right off of Roppongi, which is like the party district in Tokyo. And then they tried to shovel us over to another hotel that was not in the party district. It's like, oh, you guys are walking off the party, you know, off the streets, right under the bus to go to the shows. And it's like, and? You know, they're like, no, we can't have this. So we'll move you to another hotel in the Boeing district. And Ginza or wherever the fuck. Yeah. And, but anyways, the TVs in the hotel room, you'd flip to the porn channel. You're like, oh, fuck yeah, like, 5 minutes for free. What's this big block gonna leave? What the fuck? And, like, it's all censored, like, penetration's all censored.
No pussy, no dick.
No penetration.
But they can shit on the street, and a girl can take 54 loads of jizz on her face, unedited.
Clamps and wax.
No pubic hair.
Actually, I do remember Tom Howard was with us a lot. He was this... UPW military.
He gave Frankie and I a rush for the first time. And threw a beer bottle out in the fucking street and almost hit a biker, man. Tom Howard.
It kind of looked like Guile, you know? From Street Fighter.
You know Guile or Gully is what I used to call Will. With the blonde Street Fighter.
But he was like this military ass character, but man, I just remember him coming up to us in Roppongi out of nowhere. It was me, and I think Loki, and he was like, guys, did y'all see the Stomper Bar? I'm like, what? He's the Stomper Bar, man. It's right over there. It's badass. Like, you go in there, and you pay money, and like, they'll stomp on your nuts, high heels. They'll stomp on, like, gerbils and shit. I'm like, why would I want to? What? Like, what? Oh, my God.
Why wouldn't you want to?
So we went, and it was incredible. I still only have half a ball.
Honestly, I did get hung up by Rose Henderson in Roppongi, hung up in my underwear with my hands tied behind me, my ankles tied to me, and she was whipping me and waxing
me.
It was awesome.
That's fucking awesome.
Yeah, it was awesome.
Japan was a fucking awesome. I love Japan.
I love those goofy gooks.
Michael Shane and I accidentally, those yellow bastards. Michael Shane and I actually we closed down an all-you-can-eat yakiniku, like Korean barbecue place. It was like, all-you-can-eat, please come, take your shoes off, cover up your tattoos. And we went to this Korean barbecue place, it was all-you-can-eat. And then like the next tour, we went back and they were out of business. We'd had probably about 21 plates each. And Tom Howard and Predator were like, no, that's not possible. You know, like, whatever. I don't know. Japan, it created a a cabin fever mentality also, if you were, like, crazed, you know. I mean, when I would come back to America and just be craving a McDonald's fucking hamburger, like, yeah.
It's bizarre.
You know, it's a weird fucking place. And they, like I said, they don't shave their bushes. Poofy. I think I'm still pulling hairs off. I don't know why I even bothered.
Brian, where did Leonardo Spanky come from?
I landed on my first tour. There was press there. And they asked me about Leonardo DiCaprio, and I had no idea what they were talking about. And then a young boy told me,
Gilbert Grape, very good, retard.
Yeah. And then a young boy told me, yeah, Hashimoto thinks you look like DiCaprio. And I did one match, I think, as just a regular, you know, a Spanky. The next day, I got fucking shipped off to get my hair cut. I got measured for my trunks, and yeah, I was a fucking faggot named Leonardo Spanky. Not Spanky DiCaprio, mind you.
Leonardo Spanky.
Like, Spanky was my fucking last
name. Like a rejected Ninja Turtle.
Yeah, come on, Spanky DiCaprio. Fucking English. So, that's how it came about. But I don't know, I had a lot of fun doing it.
He loved it. He loved it. He loved taking these Japanese girls with their wooden teeth and make them pretend they were so
feeling weak. Like I'm raping them, make them do the pose.
On Titanic. Yeah, it
was... Have you ever raped anybody? You haven't raped none of you guys have raped anybody. But imagine taking somebody against their will. I don't want to do it. You're going to do it. And then drag them over guardrails. You're going to do it. And then put them up on the second rope and you're going to pose for me. And they don't speak the same fucking language, and they're nervous. It's as close as I've ever came to rape, and it was kind of fun, but that shit sucked.
Rape?
The rape part sucked.
Putting girls against their
will. And I got fucking heat, too. Why do you always grab fat girls? I'll grab any fucking girl I can... Anyways, yeah, he's dead now. But the aneurysm guy got on me for grabbing fat girls.
Zero One's awesome though. I loved it. I had a great time. I remember Carino and Loki and I found like 10 grand in the back of a cab one time in like Sapporo. It was like blizzard outside. We went to this KB place to eat. It was an all you can eat. We always scooped out the all you can eat KB places. And I just remember the three of us crammed in the back of a cab. There was a purse back there. I'm like, what the fuck? And it was. Drown off like 10 grand in the back of it, and we just divvied it up.
What'd you buy with it?
I don't remember.
Drugs. You wasted it on frivolity.
Pantyhose.
You could have fucking invested it in gold or silver.
I know.
You could have bought property.
Or Springer Bucks.
Springer Bucks?
Yeah.
That's a conspiracy I wanted to look up.
Yeah, does Jerry Springer have enough stroke in Chicago that he can issue Springer
Bucks? Yeah, Springer Bucks, is that true?
Hang his guests.
It's well, like, he knows what we're talking about.
Take these Springer Bucks.
Springer Bucks.
And they'll do you good, whether you go to Victoria's Secret or
buy a sandwich or Springer Bucks.
Dilly's hot dog stand and, you know, the place that fucking Ferris Bueller went. Like, Springer Bucks are good at all those places.
Is it really only 11:50 right now?
No, it's like,
been 11:50 for the last 3 hours.
It's like 2 in the morning. Okay. Yeah, it's like 1:49 a.m. The commitment we make.
Lay it on us. Give us anything.
Please, give us anything. We're wide awake.
Yeah.
We got a new case of beer.
I'm going to bum more Adderall off of Lee Apple Juice. We're just kidding.
DMT. What are your thoughts on DMT?
You know, I've never done DMT.
And if you have DMT, let us know, because you're looking at two guinea pigs.
How about the chamber?
Oh, the deprivation chamber?
That's a deprivation chamber.
You know, I looked up research on a place in Burbank that apparently had a bunch of deprivation chambers, and I don't know, maybe they went out of business or something? But I couldn't find them again.
I'd love to do it.
I don't know if you guys are familiar with deprivation chambers, but it's basically like an esophagus that you that you submerged in.
Esophagus.
But I think it's a sarcophagus.
Sarcophagus.
Thanks. But I think there's like a certain ratio to salt to water, but you're submerged in a level of salt water.
Where you don't feel like you're
but it's it's a certain amount to your body weight. And it gets you to a point where you're weightless, in darkness.
No sound.
Yeah, no sound. I mean, it's basically like it.
Sensory deprivation.
Yeah, it's sensory deprivation. And what this does is it eventually creates almost like a hallucinatory effect where you're you're taking on this path. And, you know, I haven't quite experienced it yet. I'm still on the path, on the hunt for it. But, different levels of experimentation, you know what I mean? Like, testing the human boundaries, you know, in a way where, like, I could look at a lot of different substances and know that these are lethal to the human body. Well, then I could stay away from them. There's no reason I'm even bothering, right? But in certain instances, you know, I've done a lot of research on DMT. Read some books on them, and the spirit molecule, you know, this is what they call it. But that's something that I think is should be examined more on like a broad spectrum, because I don't know why, but I think the government as a whole, maybe there's a lot of reservations about experimentation. You know what I mean? I think people are willing to be guinea pigs and willing to put their bodies on the line for science. I mean, I think that's a phenomenal contribution, to be honest with you. I actually have a debate ongoing with myself, but with anyone that cares to listen, where I'd like to think, you know, there's a big issue with, cruelty, not cruelty, but in the prisons, you know, executions that are deemed not inhumane, what's it called? Do you know what I'm talking about? Cruelty, but basically, I think you should take all your condemned criminals. That might be your new lab rat. You know what I mean? Why not take some of these people that are sentenced to death instead of making all the taxpayers pay all their tax monies, which I'm understood to believe we pay taxes whenever there's an execution. We're talking about executions in prisons. We pay tax dollars for executions, right?
You know what I'm sick of paying tax dollars for?
Executions.
Unemployment.
Yeah. Well, what I was thinking was, you know how like certain executions are deemed... were they inhumane?
Execute them all.
Well, no, I was just thinking, like, I think criminals and people that are deemed...
Oh, I know your thought. He wants to put them out in the ocean and have the sharks eat them.
Well,
is that what he said?
No, yeah, I've said experimentation.
He's gonna say it.
But I do think you put them out in the ocean.
I knew it.
Sharks. I mean, I think sharks need to eat, right? And
they're gonna eat.
If you give them the right predator, you know, the right feed.
Open water, those motherfuckers.
Those guys can make... They can swim back to shore alive.
Sure.
Maybe they deserve a second chance.
Sure.
They probably don't.
Like no escape.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm with you.
No, I mean, I think they should be tested, like scientifically tested, whether it's DMT or LSD or whatever, but I think these are your specimens, these criminals, which have no ends. You know you're going to kill them. You know you're going to, whether it's through firing range, which they still use in Utah, I think. Did they still use the firing range? I think that's the only state where they still use the
firing range. Is that right?
Yeah, the firing range.
Kaboom.
It's the death penalty in Utah. At least it used to be recently. But every other state is basically lethal injection or electric chair. Mm. But even the electric chair was deemed like too inhumane.
Is there no noose anymore?
Cruel. What's it called?
Does nobody get hung anymore?
Oh, there's definitely no noose.
Is it hanged or
lynching?
Hung? It's hanged, right?
Hung. You get hung.
Is it hung?
Like you're hung.
Yeah, I think you're hung.
Yeah.
Like the show.
I think when you guys look it up, and I'm gonna be the dick.
Hanged? You're hanged?
It's hanged.
You might be right.
Because I'm that dick.
You have odd knowledge.
I'm that dick. I think it's hanged.
What are your guys' favorite death penalties? Cruel and unusual punishment. That's the issue. That's what it's called.
Is that what it is?
Cruel and unusual punishment. It's a huge issue. What do you guys have any favorites? No? You're trying to be political? Good call.
Fire range is badass,
right?
Yeah,
you're going to go.
Yeah, why
so,
not?
So how many guys?
You just yelled, take it.
We got 10 of us on the fire range.
Just get fucking blown away.
How many have live ammo?
I think there's like
three out of ten.
Yeah.
Okay, maybe. that's okay. Okay.
Some street knowledge.
So you're less than 33% likely to be the one that killed the guy.
Oh, I thought it was 12 guys.
That's not bad then. I'm just made up a number. It could be 12.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
I do remember you can't do that on you can't say that on television. On television, yeah.
The slime.
Yeah, they had the firing squad. Yeah.
Alanis Morissette, that's where she did.
Was she on there?
She was on the Little Girls. Shit.
Isn't it ironic?
That's yeah.
What do you got for us?
No, I don't know. Yeah, DMT.
DMT.
Dimethyltryptamine.
I've never done it.
Outer being encounters. You know, it's
Joe Rogan loves the shit.
Yeah, I just get so tired of that guy.
Me too. But his shit with that fucking
Carlos Mencia,
yeah,
that was awesome.
Yeah, that was pretty
putting
good.
That fucking thief in his place.
Yeah.
South Park bearing that fucking dipshit was hilarious too.
I got no dick, man. I got no dick. Yeah, that's pretty good.
Fuck Carlos Mencia.
Come on, man.
The fucking hack. I'm no comedian. Well, that'd be fun.
You know, I saw George Lopez sing that Low Rider song during halftime at USC versus Arizona, the Wildcats. Last game of the season, nobody was making it to a bowl game.
I think it was on TV.
We got free tickets, my buddy Brad.
Free.
Yeah.
Jeez, right?
What's going to be on this wall?
Door's locked.
At what point, at least space.
Yes.
Space and
Benoit's eyes.
Can you do that?
The Bob Evans logo.
If it takes, I mean, I'll help out. I don't know anything
fatality.
About
Mortal Kombat. How about a Mortal Kombat fatality with the throat getting ripped out?
I mean, is it possible to do that?
Yeah.
Have weird psychedelic things flash up, flapjack. Oh.
We could be hiding from giant fish coming.
Yes.
Or octopi.
I'm sorry, Chris. All the ghosts of. We could talk shit about all the dead wrestlers and they can fucking come back to get us. Well, that's like 10 minutes. We can work them, man.
It's a paranormal activity. I'm scared of it.
I didn't say that.
It's horrible.
Really, though?
So
watching that stupid movie.
Oh, we're going. Okay.
So we've worked out. We've had breakfast. Just take us through a typical day at TV. The atmosphere.
I don't know. I mean, it's a matter of be there at this time. Are you working? You'll find out like 4 hours later. Yeah, okay.
Show up on time, or you get stooged off by one of the referees who's at the door.
Who's at the door?
Writing times. If you're late, if they don't like you, because
and you get a $500
popular,
fine. And our payday is $500, and then we have the expenses for the day. So yeah, we're fucked. To be there early to do nothing, possibly, or do something, win the world title. Who knows?
Yeah, the downtime, the forced downtime can be kind of, that can drain you, if you don't dictate your time well. But, I mean, when you're sitting there and you know you're not needed for anything, you know you're not wanted for anything, it's frustrating. It's frustrating to sit there, and it's frustrating to...
It's the not wanted for anything.
Yeah, I carried a real sense of unappreciation when I worked there, to be honest with you, because I felt like I tried every single thing I could possibly do.
Well, dude, you went from please don't die.
Yeah.
You went from please don't die. You're the guy killing himself. Do you know what I mean? Honestly.
Yeah.
No, I'm interested.
I mean, I wanted to do anything I could for this company, right? I wanted to carry its banner, but I just lost respect for it the longer I worked there. I lost respect for the guys that I used to look up to because I saw how they really were. And this is just me personally. Some guys might really like these kind of people. I don't know. But for me personally, I just... And certain guys I really liked. And I was like, cool, I'm glad these guys are really, really cool. But there was just... there was a lot of... My puffy clouds kept getting crushed. And it was just like...
man, this is disappointing in a way, you know? And when I feel like I was doing everything right, you know, and I genuinely like interacting with fans and an audience, and you know, often enough I'd be the only guy after the arena shows. I mean, I'd wait three and a half hours after the build. You know, the guys, the building would be closed up and dark, and I'd still be there signing autographs. I was like the only one.
I hate that shit, by the way.
Yeah, sorry, but I enjoy that because I was there. I know how that is to be a fan and to see these guys in the flesh and be like, wow, you know, and then to get to talk to them. But also know what it is to get blown off by these cocksuckers. And sadly, most of them are cocksuckers. And they think they're too big for their own, you know, and they just walk past, and even their baby faces. Hey, 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 hey. And just, you know, like, oh, I didn't hear anything. And they just walk, and it's like, how does that happen? It's disgusting. For me, it's disgusting, because it's just like, these fucking people are feeding you. They're paying you all their money. Most of these, the ticket prices are retarded, how high these ticket prices are, right? Especially in the economy, everything's expensive, but these people are mostly broke. This, you know, wrestling caters to, it doesn't cater to a rich audience. It does, maybe in a small demographic, but most of the wrestling audience is having money issues.
Working class.
Exactly, yeah, or lower.
But George Clooney doesn't have to fucking hang out and fucking sign shit for me. I paid to see his movie.
Right, right.
I paid
to
see his performance.
But I guess I'm just saying. I'm just saying, like,
signing my autograph. I paid my $6, my $9, my $12. I wanted to see him perform as a fucking surgeon.
I think there's a difference, though. You know what I mean? Like, I think there's a little bit of a difference.
I understand that.
I think guys have a responsibility in a public setting to an extent. You know, I think there's an issue there where.
It is being a better person. I understand. I don't know. I got you. It's the nice thing to do.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know. I guess I just can't stand all that pseudo-celebrity bullshit. Just the people walking by, like, they're better than people.
For me, for example, do you think I got that?
No.
Or I'm just I'm more of a genuine.
Because, I mean, you'd scurry to the car or whatever, and just look maybe he's shy, whatever.
Like, which I'm like, yeah.
But, I mean, I
don't even own sunglasses.
Yeah.
I don't even own sunglasses. Come on, man.
No, I know.
I'm with you. I know what you're saying.
The point is, you know, there was just instance after instance where it was just frustrating because you're sitting here and you're like, I think I'm doing everything right that would equate to a good employee and an honest employee who's defending this company and putting everything he has into this company. But it just doesn't feel reciprocated. And then the harder I work, the more I feel unappreciated. And I'm not meaning it to sound like I'm whining. It's just when you work hard and you genuinely believe in something and you care about your work, you'd like to think that it's at least valued somewhat. And I very rarely felt that. I very rarely felt valued at all. I mean, even to something like, hey, we're going to have you get eliminated by Snitsky at a Royal Rumble. To me, it was like, fuck, I'm in a Royal Rumble. That's amazing. This is like my favorite pay-per-view. This is the highlight for me.
Dude, they've been, that bump, it was a highlight for me.
Just to be in the Royal Rumble. I was like, God, this is like a dream. Another dream come true, right? Just to be in the Royal Rumble and like not get eliminated right away and set that record. It was like, wow, I get to last for a couple seconds at least, or a minute or something. So I went in there and did what I could with as many people as I could, and they wanted Snitsky to eliminate me, and I was like, well, fuck, I'm not going to just take this retard, you know, fucking elimination like every other lazy ass who's like, yeah, I just want my paycheck and just send me over the top, brother, and I was like, fuck that, man, I'm going to have my shit stand out. If I'm getting eliminated, I'm going to make sure my elimination stands out. And so it was like, what can you do? And we worked them out, and it turned out to be that clothesline that took my fucking head off. And they were like, well, we'll send an ambulance if it seems worth it. And obviously it was, because it took the attention away from the match. And then they sent out the gurney or whatever. And then I get to the back, and they're like, are you okay? And I'm like, yeah, I'm fine. And they're like, well, that was good, but it was too good. It was too good. And then I had heat or something for that. And it was like, what the fuck do you want me to do? Should be like the rest of your fucking clones? Like, that's not me. I'm not going to do that. I'm sorry. I'm just, I strive for a higher level. And I'm not going to settle for mediocrity. Sorry.
So take us back in the context of a typical day. Let's say you're at TV, you find out, let's say you're working Eminem.
Okay.
You said for 6 months Vince McMahon didn't realize you wore masks.
Yeah.
So, like, who would you have interaction with? How would the structure of laying out a match or a segment go?
Well, it's all case by case, you know. And with the last question, I love the house shows. You get to wrestle. You have to put somebody over, or you go over. You got a certain amount of time. But
like 15 minutes, a lot of time, 10 minutes.
10 minutes. And, fuck, I'm working Vladimir Kozlov, who hasn't debuted. But I get to wrestle. You know, so the difference between TV and just a house show where I'm just some schmuck coming out and losing is night and day, man. Even just losing but getting to wrestle is huge. Now, you're saying when you find out what you have to do, what's the day like?
Yeah, based on your experiences and where you guys were at, who maybe took the most time to help you and lay stuff out with you? How much freedom did you have? How much instructions did you have?
It's case by case. You know, different matches have different agents assigned.
We tend to get a lot of the same agents. So, like, I'll say Ricky Steamboat, and I'd get Ricky Steamboat, Arn Anderson, and Dean Malenko probably more than anybody. And so, specifically, I'd say Arn. Like, those three guys helped me out a lot. And I know that, you know, Brian feels the same way as, you know, Ricky and Arn. They're a phenomenal help. You know, but every agent had their pros and their cons, I felt. Every agent was working under the umbrella of the office. And very, very few agents, if any, ever had the ability to actually speak something other than the common voice. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So there's extremely frustrating situations where we'd show up to the building excited for our match, whichever agent we were assigned, depending on which, because there were other agents, not of the three that I mentioned, but others who do taxes, who, you know, would lie to us to our face. And, you know, when we would try, well, this is what they want you guys to do, and say, okay, well, what do you think about this? I don't know, guys. Well, do you mind at least running it by the office and seeing if we can do this? We know it's, you know, different than what you got. But it was an alternative to the everyday, normal, same shit. Because that's what a lot of the agents would offer, were like formulaic fixes to your matches. Like, that's what we were even asking them for. But it was like, well, this is what I used to do. And that's helpful. But also don't, you know, it helps when it's collaborative. When you can collaborate with someone, that's when you can create something. But a lot of these agents would be like, okay, well, I'll go to the office. And then they'd come back like 5 minutes later, they'd be like, office hated it, said no. And you find out they never even went to the office. And you just, you know, I'd like to think I'm an adult at that point, where it's like, look, just tell me. You don't want to go to the office and speak up for us. We'll come up with an alternative. Don't lie to us. You know, let's just lie to my face. Just, how am I supposed to respect you when I know that you're constantly lying to me? Because you're either too cowardly to tell me the truth. Well, I guess that's the only option. You're just a coward.
What was the question again?
How do you prepare a day?
Been a few, yeah.
Well, so I mean, there's instances where you could get derailed.
I just asked him what it was. What was the question again?
I guess putting it in Brian's words, would you find it was more of a collaborative effort to put something together, or were you find that you were more dictated to, this is what they want? How open were they to the collaborative, to putting something together with your input?
It was all case by case. I mean, yeah, like different agents, different philosophies, absolutely.
Well, how would you rate the experience overall? Would you say they were receptive to your ideas, or more they just wanted to plug you in a spot, this is what you're doing, overall?
Well, they had a job to do. You know, they wanted us to, you know, here's what you had to do. Some people were, better about it or not. I mean, they just have to tell you, you got to get, like you said, Eminem over tonight. You got 5 minutes. Here's how it's done. I mean, if you're asking which agents do I like, you know, Dean Malenko helped us out a lot. And I think Ricky Steamboat and Arn Anderson are geniuses. That's my opinion, long and the short of it.
When you, going back a little bit to what you said, you had that meeting, the tour of the office,
mm-hmm.
And Shane McMahon says, a tag team hasn't made an impact on me since the Legion of Doom.
Mm-hmm.
Did you regret your decision at that point to be asked to put in a tag team?
No. Paul and I talked about it afterwards, and we knew that it was pretty much what we assumed. I mean, we're fucked, you know? We're fucked. It didn't matter if people were cheering or not cheering, you know? It sounded like us, we were getting over. But I know plenty of people like, hey, did you hear the pop I got? And I'm like, yeah, I heard it. I don't think it's what you heard. So I could be one of those people. You know what I mean? But I think we were doing pretty good for people without mic time, people without care, you know, anything established other than gear, you know?
I mean, yeah, I feel like they kind of, we were in the position that we were in because our ability spoke for itself. And we were producing at house shows.
And drug tests. Other people were failing drug tests.
Yeah.
Champs.
Yeah.
While we kept the belts.
And so, but, you know, and so I think eventually they had no choice because there wasn't anyone better. But we were producing. We were, if you want a match to produce, you'd come to us. Singles, mostly Brian. but you know, you'd come to us and we'd produce. We'd put guys over, you know, they'd send all these tests at us, you know, like the Gemini, you know, they were trying to get the Gemini over. And so we had to, you know, suffer through that as far as like, well, at least the guys are willing to listen to us and we can kind of put something together. But it was just like,
Was work getting them to listen to us. So, too, we had to fight for that.
Yeah, it was. I mean, we had to like pretty much earn every bit of respect we got there. But it came, you know what I mean, eventually. If not with the workers, with the agents, you know, and stuff like that. But sadly, most people there are powerless. They're completely powerless. And they're all just, they give up all their power to the nutcracker at the top. And so, or nutsucker. So, I mean, to me, that's the biggest turnoff, really, is just like, I don't want to be surrounded by people who just, they're so ready to give up their power to somebody like that, who's doesn't even have their best interests in mind. Why should it, you know?
I'm guilty of it.
Yeah, it's a vampire of a company.
Well, it's what you, for me, and I'm sure the same as you, a kid of the 80s, born in 79, you know, fucking superstars on Saturdays, WWF, and Ultimate Warrior, and yeah, of course, man, you gotta, even after all the shit you might hear from all the bitter people, I've gotta try it.
You have to see it for yourself.
And it wasn't what I hoped for, but fuck it, it is what it is.
In the words of LeVar Burton, don't take our word for it. Reading Rainbow?
Oh, really?
Remember that?
I remember reading Rainbow.
It's in my book, take out the...
Can we take a piss break, man? Do you have to go?
Pissing rainbow. Yeah, I gotta go.
So. Okay, go ahead.
LeVar Burton, remember he's on Star Trek?
Let's talk about some of the guys that you did produce with. Memories of Wrestling Eminem.
It melts in your mouth.
Not in your hand?
Coconut flavor's good.
They are good, right?
You had coconut
M&Ms. I introduced
M&Ms.
You to them, didn't I?
Holy fuck.
Yeah.
Have y'all not been spread of this genius yet out here?
Coconut
M&Ms. I'm not kidding you.
Yeah.
They don't have the peanut filled coconut peanut filled would be fucking incredible. That'd be like all I enjoy.
Ooh.
Maybe. I don't know. Coconut M&Ms.
Yeah, I think we could agree on one thing for sure, that Deuce, right? It was Deuce. Not Domino. Domino's Cliff.
Douche.
Is the worst wrestler I've ever wrestled. Fuck. If I could say it a million times for the next however many hours you got, he's the worst.
Wrestling star from the past doesn't mean you should follow him.
All right. And that's the biggest shit talking here. He's
probably
the
be a better gay porn star.
He's the worst.
What a cocksucker.
Okay. So yeah.
Douche.
So no big shining memories of Deuce and Domino.
No, yeah, no, memories the motherfucker wouldn't fucking bump.
Yeah.
On double drop kicks. This motherfucker would come screaming across the ring and drop kick the fucker in the teeth, and he'd do everything he could to hang on to the ropes. No, I remember. I remember he's a piece of shit.
Horrible.
I remember he's a fucking piece of shit who's living off his dad's laurels. And his dad's nice, man. I bump spokes off his dad. His dad's bump spokes off me. His dad's cool, man. His dad's also told me he's going to kill me. He hates me. And then told me he loved me. All within the same conversation.
He didn't hit you with a coconut, though, did he?
No, he's never hit me with a coconut.
What was the story behind that?
Nothing. He was on crack, it turns out. Oh, I don't know if he was on crack, but I was told it was Brian Danielson, Doug Anderson, Jimmy Fly Stuka, and another student, I'm not sure what his name was, all sitting around, hey, brother, I love you, we're drinking beers, Danielson won't drink any, hey, what's wrong, and he just tells me he's gonna kill me, I'm a piece of shit, and then by the end of it, he loves me, and Doug Anderson tells me, don't worry, it's crack.
That's probably gay for you.
And I didn't know, I was too young, I didn't know what crack was, I hadn't even smoked weed at that point, you know? So yeah, that's how you wind up in the shack.
I wish you were my son, brother.
But I do like him, man. I do like him.
Yeah. Maybe you did kill him.
I know you're gonna say that, murder or not, right? Murder or not. I'm a fan.
Oh, so killed his douchey little son first. Flushed him down the toilet. And they wouldn't have been able to strong bump us.
We're gonna run into him on one of these indies, right?
I hope so.
We're never gonna run into him again.
You're never gonna get booked.
I'm not gonna take a bookie that's booking him. Are you kidding me?
Are you gonna get booked at the Samoan factory?
So, anyways, yeah.
Memories of matches and experiences with William Regal and Dave Taylor.
You know, it's interesting because I got sent to Memphis. I went to a bullshit wrestling school. I don't want to say bullshit. I went to a wrestling school in Dallas first, NWA Southwest. But I wanted more. Went to another wrestling school, Sean's. From there, got signed. Went to Memphis. That's where I trained under Regal, who was he'd been through his stint in WCW and kind of this was his trying to, you know, and fuck, I owe a lot to him. And since him and Dave Taylor are friends, Dave Taylor and I get along, we ran into each other at TNA. I love Dave Taylor, I love Regal. It's not to say Paul's gonna have the same,
No!
You know, maybe that was an elevated state of mind at some time when I worked with them and they didn't like it, but, you know, they're cool. I mean, I did tend to dropkick Dave Taylor in the ribs for some reason. For some reason, my feet just wouldn't go.
It was just meant to be every fucking time.
Every time I tried to dropkick him in the face, but like it just went to his ribs. He looks like Don Flamingo.
Because he's all ribs.
Punch out?
Yeah.
But no, I liked working with both those guys because they slowed us down. You know, they really slowed us down and like really
force you to.
To learn what you're doing in a different...
Yeah.
I mean, you're learning like nonstop with these guys, you know? So, I mean, it's a real pleasure. I would say more than working with any other tag team, to be honest with you, to get to work with, like, two real veterans.
Two guys well more experienced than us. Like,
yeah. And they're willing to bump for you. Like, these guys are... That was something that was so insulting with Douche, was that it was like, here you have Regal, who's been everywhere. Here you have Taylor, who's pretty much been, you know, a similar extent. These guys have done almost everything. They've been all over the place. They've had all the world's experiences. And they never once said, we won't bump for you. I mean, they were bumping like crazy for us, all over the place, backdrops and all that stuff. And these guys are beat up dudes. I mean, you know what I mean? You would imagine Regal and Taylor, they're beat up. They have a ton of mileage on them. But they were still there taking everything we would give to them, you know, and never complaining.
Well,
if anything, they were suggesting more.
Yeah, what Douche not bumping for you.
Yeah, and so when Douche shows up and he's just like, oh, well, you know, my dad's, you know, the hooker killer and all this, and like all this shit, and it's like, well, what the fuck, you know, like, you're not gonna bump for us, but you got these two, like, really high, you know, top class veterans, and they're, you know,
And so it was just, you know, working with them was a real pleasure. And it, you know, I learned a lot.
It was a pleasure.
Yeah, I learned a lot.
Who else do you got for us?
Memories of the four-way ladder match at Armageddon.
You know what? Honestly, before you get to that, Casey James and Idol Stevens was my favorite match that we had.
Yeah, that was
awesome. That was the most accomplished, I felt. Yeah. Because they were guys they fucking didn't give a shit about either. Casey James is awesome.
He is amazing.
Awesome. I really like Aaron Stevens, too.
Yeah, I do, too.
Yeah.
Should we tell the Casey James story?
Which Casey James? Oh, please tell the Casey James story.
We've been working Casey James and Aaron Stevens, or Teacher's Pet, or whatever. They were, you know, we were working them for months, right? Months. We were on a pay-per-view. It was like, oh, we need another pay-per-view match. Put the tag titles on her, I guess have them work wherever they're working. And so it was us and them, and it was actually in North Carolina, wasn't it?
I thought you were going to talk about the pay-per-view.
Oh, yeah, it was a little backstory. You tell stories, you get a little backstory, people are like, what the fuck is he talking about? They might still be thinking that. But, so we had this great match with them on the pay-per-view. No one expected anything. And we pulled 5 stars out of a 4-star, you know, capability.
I was very satisfied.
Yeah, we really came through with flying colors, and they were all really surprised. So that was a real feather in our cap, to the point where they were like clapping, I think, when we came back to Gorilla, which is really rare. So if the boss is clapping, that's a good thing. So all four of us, you know, we all felt really good about ourselves. Fast forward to, like, you know, 6 months later. And the other teams already split up long before and everything. And Casey James at this point was put on the new ECW as somewhat of like an enhancement guy. But he was still under contract. Always had been. So apparently, and I wasn't there to witness it, but the story is that Vince is walking by the monitor. And Casey James, phenomenal. You know, he's like 25. He's born like the late 60s. I don't know.
He's fucking Bobby Eaton.
He's in Sunday. It's weird. It's weird. Yeah, he's awesome.
Anybody's seen him. Yeah,
and Vince is walking by and he's like, he walks up, who is this kid? Sign this kid. And just walks off.
Yeah. He's like,
he's been on pay-per-view. Yeah. He's been tag title feuds. He's been under contract for a while.
I thought you were going to talk about him in Europe. In the...
Oh, with the broad?
With the... Yeah, hey, man.
Oh, yeah. Casey James.
That's what I
thought. You're looking at a way to get rats. You should be your teacher. There's this one in Europe called Big Bird. Quite a few guys have touched. She's pretty nasty. She's like a queen rat. If you can imagine a 25-year-old being... She was like a rat. She was like a 12-year-old rat when WCW was around, apparently.
That's big down here in the South, right?
Yeah. And so Casey James goes to woo this girl, and he's like, man, this girl wanted me to romance her. I wasn't going to romance her. Fucking bribe. So I went into the bathroom. I just took my clothes off, and I came back out, and I stuck my cock in her face. And she just looked scared. And then she left. I was like, we didn't romance her, man. He just stuck your dick in her face.
I hope he's doing it justice. Girl walks into a room. He takes his pants off. Here's my dick. Let's suck it. Yeah. Anyways. He's a hero of mine.
He's
Me fucking
too.
Born 20 years too late. Casey James. Fuck.
He talks like he's amazing. Emphysema, but
he
barely smokes.
So.
Casey James, if you're out there, we miss you.
What do you got for us?
The four-way ladder match at Armageddon.
Oh, yeah.
You guys, Eminem, the Hardys, and Regal and Taylor. Memories of that match.
That was in Virginia? Richmond? Yeah, Richmond,
is
Virginia.
Right? I remember I was supposed to go for sliced bread. I was terrified because I knew I couldn't do it. And I sure as shit didn't do it.
Well, like, we didn't even know. We knew we heard it was going to turn into a ladder match, I think. Maybe the day before? 2 days before?
Mm-hmm. That it was going to be a four-way ladder match. It was supposed to be Regal and Taylor, right?
Yeah, originally, and they made it. They kept that look that was the match, and then Taylor Long comes out and he's like, "Hey, player, changing the match. I'll take all your weed and never give any."
Oh no! Okay. I love Teddy.
I do too.
He's my dad. That's my dad.
I love Taylor Long, even though he never pitches in. But so yeah, that was the match, and then like I got a real treat for you, player. Two more teams. And so,
thanks.
Yeah, but I mean, it was exciting. You know, I thought it was really exciting because that was like a whole different platform for us to work on, where neither of us had an opportunity to show,
anything to that degree, at least on that platform. And so for me, it was extremely exciting, especially since we were going over.
I had no idea that Mercury got his fucking face.
Yeah, I had no idea either. No idea. I just remember looking around. I was like, someone's missing.
Shit didn't happen that was like, supposed to happen.
Yeah, it was like, something's missing. Like, something's off. And I was like, but everyone covered up for it. And then, you know.
I don't know. I climbed up the ladder as fast as I could.
Our thing with that match was that, if I can say, when you watch ladder matches in the past, so much of them are structured in like a really spotty set. I mean, it's a spotty type of match, right? But if you keep the objective of trying to win this title that's held above you, maybe not. And so as we're going into this match, what we kept thinking, and our philosophy still stands today, is like, well, if we do anything with the ladder at this point, unless it's a matter of circumstance in the situation, the ladder's going to be set up for us to climb. Because too many times we'd see, I mean, ladder matches were just a matter of setting stuff up for it just was this whole spotty thing. But it's like, well, that takes away from the realism of it. If I have an opportunity in an empty ring, I'm going to set the ladder up and climb it. At least try. I'm not going to set it up in a fucking seesaw and hope that it'll fucking get a great pop. And I'm going to win the fucking match. At least that's the illusion I'm going to portray. And so that was our philosophy. It was like, every time we'll set this ladder up, it's to climb. You know, and there are other instances where we use it, but that's just because it happened to be in that situation. You know what I mean? And so there's a whole psychology of ladder matches, I think, that has just been washed over by seesaws. But we were trying to stick to our formula of, like, this is a ladder match. The only way to get the title is to climb. That's what you do. You don't set it up to, you know. But it came out exciting, and, you know, we had... You know, and the Hardys had a lot of experience with ladder matches, so they, you know, they had their input, and we were able to tell a story with Regal and Taylor being afraid of heights. That was a really cool thing, I thought. Like, I thought that was really clever and funny, because it just was a whole different element that you don't see in ladder matches. Like, the guys that are scared to climb the ladder. It was awesome. It's awesome. And, you know, and you had Eminem, that were an established team, and, I thought Nitro did a really, you know, good job covering up from where his partner he had to. And I don't know. I mean, I guess people really seem to respond well to the match. Wouldn't you say? I mean,
people like ladder matches.
They do. You know, unfortunately, you know, I'd like to say, man, I wish I had had more chances to show that we could do stuff like that. But at the same time, it's like, well, I'm kind of glad that was it. It's just that one thing. Like,
I don't like that shit.
Then that's it. Like, it'll always be that. But we all went out there and basically killed ourselves to steal the show, and we did. Well, I mean, all eight guys, but we stole it. You know, I don't even know what the other matches on that pay per view.
I couldn't even tell you what pay per view. I think it was Armageddon. So I did it.
Were you guys given any direction or instruction as to why the rematch never happened?
With
the ladder match, they announced the second one and then scrapped it like the next week.
I don't remember. I mean,
No, they did.
Yeah, it was announced for another, well, I think February pay-per-view.
Yeah, they did.
And then they changed it.
I mean, it's because it's all on a fucking whim. And
I didn't say hi to Vince that day, remember? That might have been it.
It's just, I mean, we've got bigger fish to fry, I guess. I don't know.
Shit changes their daily.
Yeah, if it was,
I
mean,
they're writing this shit
to me
the day
all
of,
over the fucking,
you know,
show, I guess.
I mean, I'd heard of instances where I was written all over the show, and Vince took a look at it and was like, nope, not him. Took me right off. You know, like, I mean, we barely spoke to the writers in like conversations, like, well, what should we do? You know, because there was a time where we kept trying. We'd give all these ideas, and it was just like they would. I mean, it was disrespectful at the point. We would ask him, like, so what are you guys, so what are we doing? Where are we going? He's like, Taco Bell?
Yeah. Like, that was a legitimate response.
That's how they would answer us. We're sitting here trying to ask about our careers and our livelihoods, and that's how they're going to respond. You know, so
who gave us that response?
Fucking Lagana, that faggot. Where is he now?
Wait a second.
Sucking dick.
His business card?
For crack. West Hollywood.
No,
sucking homeless dick.
Yeah.
Aren't you, Lagana?
When did he get fired, man?
Oh, yeah, he did
get fired. I heard a story.
It had something to do
it
with Mortigate, didn't it?
You mean 7?
Oh, yeah, 7.
Kevin Fertig?
Yeah, suck dick for two.
Not a card anymore. If you could throw it away,
wasn't it? He wanted him to make out with him or something, and that was how he was gonna get his push. But if he didn't make out with Lugana, he wouldn't get the push. I think it was something like that. Some sort of like sexual molesting harassment thing, right?
That's the story I heard.
That's what I heard too. So David Lasagna, if you're out there, quit molesting gay bodybuilding vampire Mortigays. That. Should never be arrested anyway.
Take him to the Taco Bell, huh?
Yeah, take him to Taco Bell and give him your mini jokes. Chimichanga fucking... the fucking waste of life. Kill yourself, actually.
No, I don't care. Just
take
just,
a burrito and...
Just stay out of mind.
Oh, an insult to lasagna. I'm sorry.
I love lasagna.
I do too. Y'all made such great
lasagna. I wanted to put pork in that lasagna, but
I'm so glad you didn't. Nah.
I know you don't like pork and shit. Yeah. I don't want to throw away a half a pound of pork and a half a pound of beef and yeah, okay. So,
it's great lasagna.
Thank you.
How easy is it to get frustrated with the politics and the policies and the people that use them to their advantage?
I mean, you know, it's all a matter of perspective. It's all up to you. You know, I don't want to, you know, they're bad. It's a matter of how you take it. If you want to schmooze, you can schmooze. If you want to work out with guys to buddy up to them, you can. If you want to be, sadly, I'm somewhat childish and high schoolish. We're like, fuck you. I'm gonna be stubborn to the point of it being just stupid and stubborn, you know. And it bites me in the ass, but I don't care. I like me. But yeah, it's some people. Does the cream always rise to the top? If it sticks around long enough, yeah, I guess it will. You know what I mean? But there's a lot of bullshit floating up top, too. You know what
there,
I mean?
There, I would say the jizz rises to the top. Not so much the cream. It's a form of cream, jizz. But I think the jizz rises to the top there. So that if you can nut on the boss's face, you've jizzily cemented yourself on the bearskin rug roster. That's probably a roster. That's probably a list of names.
Probably pretty good, the bearskin rug.
Based on your experiences with them, memories of Mercury and Nitro, memories of, was it a big deal to get the tag titles to you guys? Was it something that you dug?
It's weird. Okay. Here's the deal. I was in Memphis with Mercury. And I liked them. There was something that happened where, Bobby Eaton showed up to a house show and he was a trainer. I love Bobby, man. This motherfucker.
I heard he's like the nicest guy ever. I don't think I've ever met him, but I heard he's just amazingly nice. Like, he won't let you pick up a tab or anything.
Imagine this. Imagine you're Bobby Eaton, and I'm some dumb fucking 21-year-old prick.
I'm going to give you a knee off the top.
No, there's you're on the apron. There's the ropes right here. I hit the ropes. I'm going to get him a Hurricane Rana over the ropes, and you take it to the floor. And this fucking crazy
person, he
was doing it with me, right?
That's so anyway, awesome.
Somebody called to the office. Bobby Eaton got fired, and I swear to you.
Two.
Oh, thank you, buddy. It wasn't me. But the blame got passed towards me. And Dragon stuck up for me, and fucking, of course, I stuck up for me. But fucking Joey was passing the blame towards me. He's real good at, like, schmoozing up to people that, you know, can get him ahead. So we're working Deuce and Domino. They're making their debut. And there's a lady that was working there that happened to be standing by and heard him tell them that, just treat them like jobbers. Now, mind you, we're the champs at this point. Just treat them like jobbers. Eat them up. Like anybody else. And this girl comes and tells me, you know, motherfucker, you know. And that's why these pricks aren't bumping for us. So I run into Joey. He'd been fired about a week later. I run into him in a bar. And, I asked him about it. And, why was on a lot of pills at the time, man? I don't remember. So let's just say I did it. Dude, if you don't remember, why wouldn't you say you didn't do it? So, no, I mean, I Nitro, he's got no spine, but I like him. Mercury, he's a fucking piece of shit.
And that's a shame, because I part of me likes him, but yeah. Boy, man, time and again, I'm too nice. He's a piece of shit. He's a piece of shit. Some people are.
Yeah, when I was talking about Ring of Honor and all the guys were supporting me and being helpful when I'd broken Chris Marvel's ankle by accident, Joey was one of the first guys that came to me. He was like, "Hey, man, don't let that get you down." He was like this brotherly figure. He was really helpful and like it helped me out tremendously. And
I'm the asshole.
And then we reunited in WWE and he was cool, but he was just so different. You know what I mean? Like he's just like I could tell he was already. Well, like, I was already up there before he had gotten up. And then he came up with this Eminem deal, and, like, it was, you know, the boss was, he had a hard on for it. He wanted to put the Eminem on the bear rug. And so they were the hot team. And Joey was, like, hot shit. And he was banging Alexis Lurie. And he was like, well, who hadn't seen those pictures, right? And fucking, so he was all hot shit about her.
You remember Batista putting those pictures up in the locker room?
No.
Yeah, I really? Swear to God, he printed them out and put them in the locker room. I swear to God he did, and it was the funniest fucking thing. It was the funniest thing.
Dang,
it
was.
Yeah, anyways.
But, so yeah, Joey changed. I mean, he became a different guy. I mean, I guess blame it on the drugs or whatever you want to fucking blame it on.
Yeah, yeah, don't take responsibility.
Yeah.
Yeah, don't be accountable. Blame it on substances, not yourself.
But he's just one of these cowards, you know, who's just wanting to schmooze up and be in with the boys. That's what he thought. That was right. Sour sap, you know, walk around. And the thing I never understood about Joey was like
his bad back.
He had this bad back. He'd walk around like a fucking like Sabu looked like he should be
you
a
know
what gymnast
we're talking about.
Compared to fucking Joey. The way Joey walked, Sabu looked like sprightly and young compared to the way Joey would walk around. And it was like, what bumps are you taking,
I love
man?
That. I love that. I love that.
An atomic drop. What? Oh, what? Why are you?
And that
all...
was it. That was
what?
Yeah.
I didn't even understand that. So, but yeah, I mean, Nitro was cool because Nitro was always willing to try shit and go after shit, and he was extremely athletic, and there's really nothing that he can't do.
And a super nice guy.
Super nice guy. Nice, you know, guy. Even if he lets guys bang his girlfriend and knows about it, and you know, chaperones their date. Weird. Yeah, I mean, he's a nice guy.
I think
never been behind this newer gimmick. He's always Nitro to me. He's just...
Jeff and Matt Hardy.
We're gonna have two different takes. I love them, man. And honestly, right before I got released, you know, I'd been kind of on the fence about Matt. I liked him in the past. Bad vibes, but for no real reason. He invited me over to his house. And I walked away feeling like the prick, man. He was really gracious. Jeff and I always got along. And really, I think it's all a matter of circumstance, you know? I don't think there's a good person and a bad person. I think it's just how we're introduced in the interactions. As far as the Hardys go, ultimately, I'd have to say I like them, man. They were cool with me, man. I've hung out and drunk and partied with them, and fuck, I'd like to hang out and drink and party with them again.
I'll start in chronological order. growing up, obviously, I was a fan of what they were doing, because I think the first time I really saw them was with, like, Kane or something, and he demolished him. You know, this is like when they were sort of real jobbish, like Sunflowers or something on their ties, like something really gay. And I was like, God, these guys are faggy, but I, you know.
Oh,
it seemed
I
like,
them, man.
Yeah, but I liked him. And then they had this, like, upset win over Kai and Tai on Heat and shit. I was like, oh, this guy's fucking won one. The jobbers do win sometimes. You know, I was like, sweet. And then I saw like Van Damme's match with Jeff, and I thought that was cool. So I'd follow their shit because to me it was like, oh, these are guys that, you know, don't so much look like stars, but they're successful and they've created quite an amazing following, you know. And then even getting in, you know, getting
into WWE, I had, you know, a series of dark matches. I'm trying to remember the... But I had a series of dark matches. I think my last actual dark match was with Matt.
That was it, though. That was the big one. And yeah, I think he went to bat.
Yeah, and so,
he
like...
He really did. It was an awesome match.
That one really helped me, and he gave me a lot.
It was a good match, though.
Yeah, it was a good match. It was good. He hit me with his finisher twice, and it just made me look stronger. And, like, I remember Carino pointing that out, because, you know, I was still really trying to learn this stuff. I was like, I don't, you know...
As a local nobody, man.
Yeah, I mean, it was cool. I was really thankful for it. I loved it. And he's, you know, he was very supportive. And he still seemed supportive when I was in OVW, and I liked those guys. And I ran into Jeff at Ring of Honor, my last Ring of Honor match. He had recently left WWE or whatever, and he was starting a Ring of Honor. And so we just kind of, like, went in this transition where I was going there and he was just leaving. But we always got along. And then in working there with these guys, it was fine. I think just a matter of the atmosphere. When you're in a wrestling atmosphere around a lot of people, things tend to, you know, you tend to interact in a lot of different ways, you know. And so, one second I'm at a casino getting, you know, mauled by Ashley Massaro, and that leads to a fucking relationship. You know, and I don't know what to think.
I so happened to be there, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know what I, you know, but I'm, and so, you know, my understanding is that there was no relationship there anymore, and I wasn't even aware of that. Because honestly, to be honest with you, I never thought, like, I don't know if it was just a bad mindset I had for myself. I mean, the place had really, like, unfortunately, I had gotten to a point where my confidence had really become diminished. And I don't know if it's just a matter of repetition, the same weight, same old shit, where you feel like you're kind of at this level, and then you think that there's, like, kind of this upper echelon of talent that's, like, way up here. Well, that's how I considered a lot of those people. So, like, truth is, I never even thought about these people. Even Ashley, because she was, like, their prime girl, right? She just won some contest or something. So none of these people were even in my train of thought, right? So when one of them was almost interacting with me, I was also almost kind of like, wait, you know that, like, I'm not looked at as anything valuable in the company, right? Like, you know that I'm, you know, I mean nothing in this company. You know that, right?
You had a shiny gold belt, man. A shiny gold belt.
But at brass tacks,
yeah.
I'm not liked in this company for whatever reason. Maybe I'm just too honest, but so that was the situation, and so I'm getting this attention from this, you know, this girl at the time, and it's very appealing, and so, wow, oh, great, and I got kind of carried away with this thing, but then, you know, come to find out there's still all this emotion there and everything, and it's got kind of swiped up into this retarded triangle of nonsense, right? But you learn with relationships, and every relationship is like a trial and error, and so I think there was a lot of confusion there, specifically between Matt and I, where, you know, to me it was like, well, I don't buy into the whole thing of like, oh, well, if you dated this girl, it's hands off. And it's like, you know what, if you dig somebody, you dig somebody. Fuck it. If you really care about them, then what makes them happy should ultimately be what makes you happy, even if it's not you. You know what I mean? And he couldn't accept that. He couldn't accept that. But at the same time, you know, I was still fairly young and I had a lot of naive capabilities to me where I was just like, oh, this is so exciting, you know, Playboy, who cares? But, you know, it was a fun time, but at the same time, I felt like, well, I'm not going to be like some of these other guys, like Nitro, who just knows that his girlfriend's getting banged by, you know, Batista or whatever, and lets it, okay, you know, what can I do about it? And it's like, no, you know, it's how I've always felt. If someone, and I don't know if it was a matter of maybe she, of her just lying to me, you know, but from what I understand, you know, they were well over, and she would tell me all these horrible things about them, and I would try not to judge them, and I'd just be like, hey, you know, well, that's in the past, and I'd try and just focus on us. But it seemed to just always be kind of like this thorn in my side, where it was kind of like, God, am I never going to hear the end of this guy, and like, it's just, and so it was a nasty atmosphere. It just created a lot of bad blood that I think stemmed from a lot of miscommunication, to the point where there were times when I would have to ask her, like, what are you doing? Like, do you want this guy or me? Like, make up your goddamn mind, you know? Like, I'm too old for this shit. And you would think, you know, I just got strung around a lot. And eventually it got to the point where I was like, okay, well, if you want to be with him, then that's fine. If that's what you want, if that's what's going to make you happy, then I'm fine with that. And I went up to him, and I specifically said, just stay out of my life. I don't want to have anything to do with either of you. Like, this has been so stressful. Like, I'd rather just not bother. And, I mean, I could go into details, but I started to really lose respect for the guy just because I saw how he started to treat me as a result of it. Like, it was just a lot of things that occurred, and I was just like, this isn't the same guy that I thought I liked and thought, you know, was cool. And just the more I heard about him, the more I was like, I can't see how people don't see right through this. This is a joke, you know what I mean? Like, and I think that got mixed with a ton of the emotions that I was feeling at the time, just because I was, you know, I'm a pretty passionate person. And when I'm involved with somebody, you know, I take a lot of pride in it, and I'm willing to stand up for them. But when that person's maybe giving me mixed signals and telling me things that aren't true, I mean, it leads me astray. And so I'm kind of just left as this guy who's only half filled in on the information, but yet he's trying to be as honorable as possible. And, you know, like I said, it just created a lot of bad blood and a lot of just, it felt like stupid high school nonsense. But the more I heard about him, the more I just didn't like him. And I didn't like what I heard about the guy. And he didn't do anything to prove otherwise to me. He definitely didn't do anything to say, oh, no, I'm actually a decent guy.
I wish, man, you guys could...
Yeah, I mean, it might happen someday.
I hope it does. I hope you guys can shake hands and say, shit happens. I really do.
Out of what little respect there is left, you know, there's things that
That'd be great, though, man. It would. It'd be nice.
It would. You know, it's not something that I harbor so much over. And it, you know, it used to be something that really bothered me because it was just like, God, I need to expose this guy. He's such a foul person. But then I just stopped caring because it wasn't worth it. You know what I mean? But and then to flip over to Jeff, I mean, I always liked Jeff. Jeff and I, we had phenomenal chemistry together. I mean, we had a blowout match in Mexico City.
Fuck!
It was like probably my favorite match, dude, other than the ladder match I ever had in that company. And I got to be a heel on Jeff because we had started this tour in Mexico. And it was funny because the first day of the tour, I didn't work and Brian did. And the last day of the tour, I worked and Brian didn't. But it started off that way because I had a big fucking black eye, compliments of Bob Holly, because I got to the gym before he did. And I finished before he did. Right. And I made grunting sounds. So he punched me in the face.
Attention.
No.
Yeah.
No, we did it. We had worked Cody and Bob before going to Mexico. And a spot I like to do where I lay on my feet and turn around. We were healing it up a little bit at the time. I was like, hey, and like, why don't you just punch me, Bob? I was like, yeah, I like that. He punched me.
But don't really punch me, Bob.
Like, this is the biggest fucking black eye. But I love Bob, so I didn't care. And I was like, and he just liked me even more for not bitching about it. It's wrestling. It's not fucking ballet. You hear that all the time. It's true. So they were like, we'll flip a coin, guys. And I won the coin toss. And I was like, I guess you're working. And so
Charlie Austin, yeah, we don't need to get into the details.
Yeah, no details there. So he worked the first night and I didn't, but then we did.
Boy, what a match.
That's a heart stopper. And we did the whole tour, and then we were working Cody and Bob the whole tour. And like the second to last night, Brian hurt his foot pretty bad somehow. I don't even remember how that happened.
Yeah, it was a nerve on the top, and it just swelled up. And fuck, I couldn't stand it. That's when Martha was gonna help me out and went
sightseeing. Who's Martha?
Dr. Martha.
Oh, yeah, his wife.
No.
Doc's wife.
Right? Not Doc's wife, the other lady, the new lady, Martha, who's gonna go, she went sightseeing in DC instead of setting up. Anyways, fuck it, who cares? I liked her.
Thanks, Mark.
And it was my foot was fucked up. So Paul worked Jeff Hardy, and I'm gonna interrupt him. The match was fucking incredible, and the way they had it set up, it was a slow ba-boom, ba-boom, ba-boom finish. When they get back, Dean Malenko says, and we're all sitting in chairs like this, well, yeah, it was a good match, but, you know, you could have made the match more sudden. And I don't know if you remember me saying this, but I said it for everybody, Dean, what the fuck was wrong with that match?
I do remember that.
Yeah, I did. And he was and I could have gotten shit, but fuck it. What the fuck was wrong with that match?
Yeah.
That match was amazing. Everybody was going crazy. There was nothing wrong with that match. Some motherfuckers want to critique something because it justifies their job. That match was incredible. That's the best match,
man.
I've seen
or
Jeff had. That match was fucking unreal.
It was fun. It was like highlights for me.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I mean, working on Jeff's so easy.
That was awesome, man.
So easy, because he's so over, too, so that's so easy, you know, to do any kind of healer shit, get a reaction. But, I mean, we just had good chemistry. We always have. Even teaming with them, it was fun, you know what I mean? Because we did a lot of six-man stuff with Jeff. We had a lot of great matches. I think we did a pay-per-view, us and Jeff against Caden Murdoch and Kennedy.
We did a six-man
with us against Caden Murdoch and Benjamin. And so they teamed us with Jeff fairly often. I think they saw there was a lot of relation there as far as styles and stuff.
He's
like
got
that.
Some sort of magic, man. He's just over, man.
Awesome.
I loved him when I saw him as a kid. He's just he's just got it, man.
Yeah.
He's awesome.
No, he's
definitely
a cool fucking guy.
Yeah.
But, you know, and then to wrap it all up, I mean, you know, definitely an influential tag team. Take from them what I did and take from them what I could learn from. Definitely have, you know, things that I don't like about their matches, and I think I alluded to that in the ladder match explanation, where it's like, well, when I think about it, no, we'll climb these ladders. We don't need to set them up to get pops for ourselves.
I'll agree with that. I the Hardys are awesome. What I would rather be instead of the Hardys is psychologically different. Yeah,
much.
I want
much
the
different.
Belt. That's and I'm gonna base the psychology around me wanting that belt, and you can bump me on my way to the belt, but I'm going for that fucking belt. I'm not setting up the ladder outside the ring. I'm not setting it in the corner. I'm setting it up in the belt. And that's, I guess, the difference. But, man, they're fucking... I love them. They're awesome, man. And who sold more merch? Well, fuck them. More
Mysterio.
Than anybody, man. Well, Mysterio, but yeah. But them, we sold 11 shirts. They sold
Batista.
A gazillion. So, yeah. They're awesome.
We sold 11, really?
Maybe, I don't know.
I have my mom, but
now I have one. And I bought two of them.
Haas and Benjamin.
I've known Charlie, trying to think since when, 2001 in Memphis. Benjamin, I met a few years after, a little bit here and there. Fuck, I don't know. I like him, you know. I'd love to see him in TNA. I'm doing a little bit of stuff there now, and fuck, I don't know. I like the guys.
Yeah, there's. I don't know. I mean, sometimes it's a little bit of a headache to put matches together with them, just because, you know, they took their collegiate accolades too seriously sometimes. So they just be like, hey, we'll come here and just. We're wrestlers. There's no way you could do that on us. We're wrestlers. No way.
I mean, there's not ropes in collegiate wrestling. There certainly ain't turnbuckles. Yeah.
You know, I think they took themselves a little too seriously and whatever. But I always had fun working with both of them, either individually or in a tag situation. It was always pretty easy, you know? Like, it was always fun to do. And
Charlie might rip your shoulder out and arm drag. Though.
Yeah, Charlie
he's fucking.
I mean, he's
like,
oh,
I like Charlie. But
yeah,
he's
I love Charlie. He's just like an intense.
Intense as it gets, yeah.
Because intensity is dangerous.
Mm-hmm. Fucking Charlie.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I mean, yeah. I like Haas and Benjamin for sure.
Caden Murdoch.
I broke in with Cade. You know. Murdoch, had a slapping incident with him.
Oh, yeah. He likes to slap people on the back or something.
He'd like to slap guys in the stomach and the back. And you
it's
know,
like
he,
fat guy chops.
Yeah.
Bubba Dudley does that kind of gay shit. It's like fat guy chops.
And
if you're too unathletic to chop regular, you just chop the stomach.
he pulled that shit with me once without telling me, bam, 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 and I was fucking livid after a match in Mexico. Stormed out afterwards, and you know, he tried to act tough, and like, you know, I was pissed, man. Motherfucker, you don't, this is bullshit. You do it again, I'm gonna slap you in the face, sort of deal. And we you know, it wasn't like, I'm blowing up to him, we discussed it, but dude, you don't slap me here, you do that, I'm gonna slap you here. And, fuck, next time he slapped me on the stomach, it was on TV, and I started slapping the shit out of his face, man. And I like Murdoch, I like Cade, they both been over to my place, man, I like them. That's the only story I got. I you know, Murdoch slapped me in the belly, I slapped him in the face like a little bitch. Ta-da.
We were lobbying to work with those guys for a while, because they were on Raw, they were like the Raw.
We had awesome matches with them, man.
Yeah,
and awesome we were at SmackDown. I thought.
Yeah, so we were really trying to get over to work with them, whether bringing them to SmackDown or going to Raw, and when we started working on them, it was just...
Initially, there was, like, a feeling out process, you know, but...
Keeping the belts warm for us, though.
Oh, is that what he said?
You remember that? You told me about that.
Oh,
yeah,
Murdoch?
Yeah. Thanks for keeping them warm for us.
Oh,
we're in South Africa.
Yeah, like, it's on, just like, I don't know. Thing is, like, certain guys get up, you know... When guys get on TV or they start making some money, I mean, they're gonna think that they, you know, they're gonna start taking things for granted and start getting this kind of delusional attitude. And Murdoch would drift there more than Lance would. But Murdoch's also a lot more country than Lance, and so.
Yeah, and I do like them both.
I like
them
both.
They're welcome over my place anytime.
Yeah, just like
real easy, real easy. Excellent chemistry. Safe. I mean, it was fun to work with.
Yeah.
It was actually a shame we didn't really get to do more, like develop more stuff.
Well, we ran in one day, and beat him up, and then because they were beating up Triple H, if you remember, and then we got him scrambling out of the ring, and then Triple H went to shake our hands. And then kicked one of us, I don't remember who, first in the belly.
Faggot.
And the other one just stood there in place. And we both took pedigrees. And Paul kept insisting, when are we going to get a revenge? And week after week, I don't know if you went to Michael Hayes, different agents.
Oh,
when are we going to get a revenge? When are we going to get
basically
a revenge?
Basically, we just look like pussies. You just
pussies.
Like get beat up.
Pussies.
And don't have any issue with it. It was so
pussies.
Frustrating. Especially because that fucking Tool terrorizing, he fucking came up to us. Before the show, and he was like, hey guys, I just want you to know that this is indeed a camel toe. And he said,
he did say something though.
He comes up to us, he goes, oh, I looked on the TV sheet and. This is what the office wants, guy. It's Kevin Dunn. That's what Kevin Dunn wants. I mean,
you know,
I had nothing to do with it.
I'm out of the bearskin.
I had nothing to do with it. That wasn't Vince's dick in my mouth. It was Stephanie's and Shane's. It was a DP in my mouth. That's the real pedigree. Double pedigree. That's what DP stands for. And, Jesus.
GDP, though, man, does yoga in my front grass. You know
awesome.
That, right?
Yeah.
I've told you about that.
Devil's Rejects is way better than fucking Royal House of a Thousand Corpses.
Oh, no comparison.
And DDP
that's
has
shit.
A little bit of ability to be the reason why that's better.
Devil's Rejects,
amongst other things, but DDP
is
awesome.
is a legitimately like awesome horror movie.
Yeah, it's badass.
Yeah, Thousand Corpses sucks cock. Yeah,
I'm just trying too hard. To
what other horror movies you want to talk about there?
The Undertaker.
They're making an Undertaker movie.
Are they really?
I heard,
dude. Dude, when I saw him on fire, I thought...
How awesome was that? Who's powers? He can't even put out fire on his own?
We were... No. I was with Jordan. Gonna meet you. I was with my buddy Knuckles at Hamburger Habit off of Pico in L.A.
Really
and we were
good.
Watching... And this shit is on CNN. Well, we're eating fucking hamburgers. This motherfucker... Well, we're eating fucking hamburgers. I was in heaven, man.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
How many lives does he have left? I don't know. There was some really good Undertaker, and there was some Undertaker who was just kind of like, huh? Is this the same guy?
The weird thing was the way people would act around him. You know what I mean? The change of behavior, because obviously he's an authority figure. He's been around, you know, he carries some clout. And people who you might be riding with and might be boys with would fucking turn around and to him, thinking they might scoot up a little bit.
Oh, it's disgusting.
And I can't blame it on him. But at the same time, he was listening to
it. He relishes that, I think. You know,
I didn't like the way people behaved around him.
Like being dragged in my fucking room at 3 in the goddamn morning in Australia to come downstairs to fucking look at all these grown old fucks act as courtroom and have wrestler's court in a fucking in a ballroom of the hotel lobby. We're on the end of an Australian tour. Don't drag me in my goddamn room at 3:34 in the morning to come watch The Undertaker act as Judge Judy to fucking
picture this.
Oh my god,
you're working Eminem for a whole loop and it's going good. New Zealand, fucking the best houses you've ever worked in front of. Yeah. Australia, bam, 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 awesome tour. And the valet for him is on court for not fucking shaking hands or some bullshit that goes on in the women's locker room.
There's a ton of other shit too, like making passes at Benoit and all that.
Who knows, man? But we have to fucking bet. We're forced down there. We have to bet. At what time is the girl who's on trial gonna cry at? We're picking times. I say 1 second. I lose.
That's disgusting.
My buddy says like, 10 minutes. He fucking wins. And doesn't want to fucking win.
That's so bad. It's disgusting. You see this girl like getting raked across the coals by all her friends who are now coming out because everyone's watching this.
Oh, it's so, I mean, it's disturbing.
Parts like that where it's like,
and I like the girl, and I know you do too. She's a nice girl.
Yeah, I got it over the dime. She can see, and like, you know, and so. I just think, actually, it's aesthetic dentition. but, you know, so there's elements of that. Personally, I'm not a fan of people who love themselves. Like, I love myself, but it's because I know what I'm made of. I don't need to tell everybody else.
What are you
else.
Made of?
I'm made of a lot of good SpaghettiOs.
Give me a little taste. Not the spaghetti. What are you made of, Paul?
It's like a crystalline orange that glows. Except it has almost a green hue like this. That's because that orange is blazed.
You have no idea what your hair looks like right now.
No.
Yeah, you do.
It's like jizz.
No, it doesn't. It's waving.
I put jizz
it's magical.
Jizz makes your hair strong. But I'm just not a fan for people who wear their own merchandise. I'm not a fan for people who, you know, put, you know, dead man on their license plates when they drive around the town that they live in, because I have to live in the same town as him. It's my town, motherfucker, and not yours. I've been there a lot longer than you, old man.
Born and raised, motherfucker.
Jesus Christ. You don't know what weird is, motherfucker. I'll kill you for real. All that I know is it's going to light you on fire.
What's your weakness?
Fire. Yeah.
You got any questions for us?
Randy Orton.
Love Randy.
Yeah, me too, man. We've had some fucking funny stories,
One of my favorite people.
Oh.
Actually, if I could see a crossover star into like another rock type, into, say, entertainment, like acting or whatever, as far as like show busy acting, I could see Randy being that guy. Because he just has so many natural talents. But I don't think that would happen just because I know how much he loves wrestling. But, I mean, it's like, he's a pretty flawless performer. I mean, the guy's...
He's your next Shawn Michaels, yeah. Man. He's your, he gets it. He feels it.
Yeah, he's a pretty phenomenal guy.
And the agents fucking love him.
Yeah, they're all
these guys understand.
Yeah. They're in shorts and shit. And they're just like, oh, I just jerked off Randy's picture.
Well, I mean...
Interesting.
You respect Arn, I respect, and they all fucking, They know he's good. Yeah. We know he's good.
He's a franchise guy. Him and Cena. They're franchise guys.
He can do this and make it something. No, Randy's awesome. Yeah.
Yeah.
And we've had a lot of fucking fun in Mexico and South America.
Oh god.
Yeah, we've had Dynamite. And
I'm surprised we haven't been arrested.
What was that band? In South Africa. I'm all out of love. Air Supply.
Oh, Air Supply. Yeah, yeah. Pissed on them.
Kind of.
Yeah.
Kind of.
There was an incident when we were in South Africa. And we were working Caden Murdoch. That was a feud we had. We were all... It was like towards the end of the tour.
We were the champions.
We were the champs.
We were the raw champs.
Keeping them warm, Murdoch. Doesn't contribute to the pile either. Unless it's Mexican dirt weed. Doesn't count.
It's the luckiest thing in your life.
Oh, God. You have to get a human tornado in here. To ask him how he feels about Murdoch. So we were in South Africa... And everyone came into, like, for some reason, even though I knew the office hated me, I would always get these, like, really pimped out rooms on the road, like, in international tours. Everyone would be like, hey, man, what room are you in? I'm like,
we're in
201.
I'm like, your room.
I'm like, oh, I'm over, like, in the Paradise Suite, man. Like, what do you, I think they thought I was, like, Paul Levesque or something. Unfortunately, my name sounds similar to that almost. I'd always have these pimped out rooms. Anyway, so everyone would meet in my room where you catch a burn or whatever. And so it was me and Brian and Cade Murdoch and Randy.
And Robbie.
Robbie McAllister.
McAllister was fucking cool as shit, man.
Cool, man.
I do like the Highlanders. I do like that. And Robbie was cool as fuck.
Yeah, really
man.
Cool.
He voted no.
Yeah, so we
he voted
so,
no.
I guess Air Supply was staying at our hotel. And
in like, South Africa, mind you.
Because where else are they gonna play it? So we look out the window because we hear a lot of commotion, and Cena's out there with all the other schmoozers, right? And they're all just wanting to be around top guys because that's what happens. And so they're all at the table, basically outside my window, where the pool area is. And
we're up 8th floor.
Yeah,
they're maybe 20 feet down that way. From the 8th floor, so
they weren't right below, but they were inside.
But they were, yeah.
There was a couple windows that opened, but there was one prominently kind of in that area. And so, you know, at least to say we were pretty elevated mentally at that point. And I think it was just as simple as you wanted to take a piss out the window?
Yeah, I wanted to try to see if I could piss on him from there.
Yeah.
That was all it was.
Brian had bought Cena's latest rap album and didn't approve of it, so he wanted to piss on
him. And that's another guy. I can't say enough good things about
him.
I really like John. But I wanted to piss on him, because I think he might think it was funny.
Yeah.
You know? And I know I would think it was funny. So I wanted to piss on him and whatever nerds he was hanging out with.
But it was a little windy, and so the wind carried the piss over onto Air Supply. Instead, who was sitting nearby.
But that's the story. In actuality, it hit the hotel management.
Oh.
That's who it hit.
I didn't know that.
The story was Air Supply. I pissed on the hotel management. And that's when they threatened to call the cops.
Yeah, we show up in the next morning and they're like, the schematics points to your room. And like, schematics? How do you even spell that? I bet you can't. But it all smoothed over.
Yeah, it was the squirt going out the 8th floor.
Stroke.
Yeah, so. Yeah, and I don't know, did Cody suck Air Supply's dick, you think?
I think he did. I think
did Air Supply suck Cody's dick?
Yeah, I think it's.
I
think
don't
it was
think
a
so,
threesome.
But it could have happened.
No, I think it was a threesome. Cody was trying to show him the yoga he had learned from DDP.
Bang, who
and
does
Air
it in
Supply.
My front fucking yard,
yeah,
man?
That's right. It's pretty it's true.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but Cody's on the bear rug, I think.
No.
I think so.
No.
I think Dusty Hunts is on bear rug. Maybe.
What do you got for
him?
Sit on the bear rug, baby.
What about him?
Thoughts on him, Baptist interactions with him over the years?
He's been nice to me.
I really
he's
like
jacked.
Dave, to be honest with you. Yeah, Dave's never been.
He's super jacked. He's super cool. He's got an awesome motorcycle. I know that much.
He's always been really cool to us.
I don't know.
I know there'd be times when, I remember specifically, we were out in Washington, D.C. I don't know if we were on, I think we were on separate shows at this point, but.
Where he would throw parties?
Well, yeah, because he's, like, from the Baltimore, Washington area. Mm. But I just remember, like, he'd always have these... After we'd wrestle at the MCI Center, whatever it was called, in D.C., he'd always have a party, like, at a club nearby and just, like, pick up, like, the tab for everybody. And it was just, like, retarded.
Dude, he would do that on any time you went out.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it's true. I mean, but he's just... he was a good dude.
You know what it was? And he said it, and Cena said it. It's just a matter of, and Randy would always pick up the tab too. They'd be real sneaky about it. They'd pick up the tab, and it was a matter of, they know they get paid a lot more, and they know they're wrestling, and we're wrestling, and they know that they need an undercard, but at the same time, I mean, they don't. We could be anybody, but dude, all the top guys there were real cool, young guys too. I mean,
I wouldn't say all the time.
No, but John, Batista, and Randy would fucking, you go out to eat.
That's true.
They'd pick up the tab, even if you weren't sitting at the same table. Man, I mean, yeah, cool guys, yeah.
Benoit, even. Benoit,
dude, I mean, a lot of wrestlers learned that.
Benoit,
just
Benoit, actually.
I did too, I did too, he was crazy.
He was.
But.
Threatened to give me cauliflower ears one time.
Hey, how about Montreal?
How about Hooters? Did I ever tell you that? So we were in Buffalo, New York, and I was riding with Jamie and Brian, or Jamie and Chris at the time. Brian, I think, had just left, like, not too long
ago. Probably got the fuck out of there by then.
And we were in Buffalo, and so we're driving to the hotel, but Chris was hungry, so I was like, let's go to Hooters, and I think it was, like, already 11:30. They were closed, and they only had, like, one table left in there. And they're closing the door, and he, like, sticks his foot in there. He's like, still open. And so he kind of forces us in there. It's just he and myself and Jamie. And we go to sit down. And so the table behind us has kind of been real raucous and everything. And they're, like, giving the waitress a hard time. He's like, those motherfuckers are irritating me. And I'm like, oh, yeah, they're kind of loud. And he's like, you should go do something about it.
You should go do something about it. You mild-mannered.
You, with the blue tights and the white spermy juice. like, okay. And so I go over to this table. I'm like, hey, guys, can I keep it down a little bit?
He's going to get me.
My buddies here, we're tired. And also, you kind of giving the girl a hard time, guys. I mean, just chill out. Yeah. Well, sorry, man. We giving you a hard time, too. I'm like, hey, man, just being a little loud. My friends are getting kind of irritated. Like, why don't your friends come and say something? Like, then they looked over and like they quieted down. I was like, well, "Hey, look, man, just chilling." He's like, "No." I was like, "We've been rude to the girl." You know, I was trying to like pull whatever this defense was out of my ass. And then anyways, they were like, "All right, no, that's cool." And like, so we're gonna sit down. And then they come over and they're like ready to give it. Like, "Hey, we just wanted to say no offense." Oh man, Chris Benoit, man, he, like puts it like this, and the second he puts his hand on his shoulder, Chris just goes, "Get your fucking head off." No disrespect, man. Like, he's just in this zone. It was insane.
You know, I did the same thing to Sign Guy. Oh, he did it at a Hooters. He put his hands like, we're all buddies. Get your fucking hands off of me. So I get it.
It's great. I love it.
Fuck him.
So these guys leave, and the girl comes up, and she's like, oh, hey, you didn't have to do that. That was really nice. And I'm like, you didn't have to do that, And so then she goes and puts our order in and everything, and they're like, okay, it's set. You're gonna fuck this girl. You're gonna fuck her. And we're gonna watch from the closet and jerk off. And I was like, what in the fuck did I get myself into? What? I slipped in like the Canadian Twilight Zone or something? Like, I didn't understand what the fuck was going on. And Jamie goes to the bathroom. I'm like, Chris, man, like, I have a girlfriend, like, at the time, I was like, it's not really my thing, man. And he's like, no, you don't have to do anything. I know, it's cool. Then Jamie showed me, goes, no, you're going to fuck her, and we're going to watch and jerk off in the club. He doesn't have cauliflower ears. We should rough him up. And I was just like, this is getting a little homoerotic for my taste. I'm not really into this kind of thing, guys. And but, yeah, we still rode together. I just would get my own room. Because it was safe, and it was really, it was interesting riding with Chris. I mean, it was real intense, but he always was willing to give advice, you know what I mean? He was like, you need to fight back more, you need to, you know, pick your points to fight back, and he just really invested a lot of time in Brian and I. But I was getting that earlier. There was a time when we were finishing up a tour in Zurich, Switzerland. And that was the last stop. And we were at the bar and drinking and stuff like that. And I remember Chris came up to me and he said, "You and Brian, that's what's going to make money here in the years to come." And I was like, "Well, you know, we're trying." Something goes, no, against each other. He's like, "That's what the future of this company is you guys against each other. That's going to be the feud for the ages." And I was like, "Wow, thanks." You know, and like, I mean, he was just like extremely respectful of the fact that we had tried to go about, you know, our careers in a similar fashion that he had and Benoit had, you know, going to Japan and just trying to make your way out there. So I don't know, Chris really always took an investment in us, you know, he always tried to keep us on the track, I think, to be what he thought was ideal.
What does that say about us?
That we're not crazy.
Fuck, he was awesome, though.
Yeah, he was.
Fucking man. I mean, the intensity.
I mean, when that guy would tell you that he really liked what you did, I mean, that would make up. Like, honestly, that's what gave me a lot of longevity was the respect I gained from peers that I respected. Because when you're rejected by the office that you're trying so hard to please, every night you're just rejected nonstop in a disrespectful way, too. You know, real condescending relations. To get a compliment from someone like a Benoit or a Steamboat or, you know, the guys that are actively working, and it was Benoit at the time, I mean, that would just smooth all, it would be like, okay, this was worth it, you know? And all that disrespect that you would get from the office and all that bullshit wouldn't even matter, because it was like, I got this guy's respect, that's above anything, you know?
But
I wasn't surprised with, you know, what happened.
Oh, you shitting me? I was sitting this far, if you were Jimmy Yang, from Jimmy Yang, and when the hysterics happened, I looked over at Jimmy, and that was it. We knew what fucking happened.
Was that before or after you heard Matt Stryker go,
"No!" Come on, man. It happens every day.
It's down there, isn't it?
You know, I mean, shit happens, man. I mean, I really hope I don't kill my wife. I really, really hope we don't have kids first and I kill her and them. I mean, fuck. No, and I'm sure if you would have asked him 10 years in advance, fuck no, I don't want to have a wife and kids and kill them. Nobody wants to, but...
Even a week in advance.
You know, shit happens, man. I mean...
He actually called me about 2 weeks before I went down.
About the dogs?
Yeah,
come on, don't be a dick. You're an asshole.
He called me, I would say about 2 weeks before that went down to check on my mental stability, to check on how I was holding up. Because I'd had a rough patch there for a while where I was coming back from an injury and I was just like having really shit match after shit match. And I was just like frustrated. And I was just getting really depleted. My confidence was just like, what the fuck? I can't get out of this funk. And I was walking around really just like, ugh. And so guys were like pulling me aside and like, "Hey man, what do you want?" I'm like, "Nothing. I'm just, this sucks. It's fucking, I don't, you know." And they're like, "Okay, well, you just need to keep your smile, you know, because that's the game." And,
yeah, be phony, okay. Be fun.
But then Benoit's calling me at my house and was like, "I just wanted to check on you." So it was like weird. I'm okay. I'm fine. And then 2 weeks later, all I had was like,
I'll tell you though, he bizarre. Loved the Bible, and they all love the Bible, huh? Isn't that spooky?
Born again.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Born again, kill again.
Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah. No, they didn't play with dice.
Chris did. He's a big RPG guy, yeah.
Really? What games did he play? Final Fantasy?
Magic.
Did he really?
Pokemon, yeah. He was really.
He's a Pokemon guy?
I love Pokemon. Oh, yeah. No, he really did. Yeah.
Damn.
Real good sandcastle maker, too.
He didn't go to Portland. And it wasn't Portland. Where was it in Oregon? Where they have the sandcastle festival?
Astoria.
Really? Yeah.
Home of the Goonies.
He never went, though. He's not that good.
No. Sloth would never
Wait, he wasn't that good. Come on, man. Nice. He'll never make a sandcastle again. Not in that physical form. No.
A couple little things we'll touch on that we haven't touched on yet.
Couple big things.
George Lopez, yeah. Certainly.
Paul, remember...
Billy Jack Hayes. Benoit. Vince was the father. Fuck them all. Oh, come on. You got that for me, right?
I'm a bear rug.
He doesn't even know what I'm talking about. He does, but he doesn't. That's fucking genius.
Bombshell tonight.
You, I got hepatitis.
Fire!
Do you guys know, like, you fucking genius, right?
Yeah.
I love it. Okay. I'm done jerking you guys off, but I love it. I love it.
I haven't even started.
He'll jerk you off once he sees.
Yeah. The camera stopped rolling.
A couple things we haven't touched on yet. Paul, memories of teaming with Billy Kidman.
You know, I liked Kidman when I was watching WCW when I was growing up. Like, I was like, oh, he's another guy I can relate with. He's about my size. And if I could grow into being a pro wrestler, I could see myself going into the mold of this guy. And, like, he'd be someone I really... Oh, thanks a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Get yourself one.
I got one right here.
Cheers-y-o. He's a guy I can relate with. My size, I really like the style. I mean, I saw him do the Shooting Star before I saw Jushin Liger do it. You know, Jushin Liger, I just had reference because I had heard he was the first one to actually attempt it, so.
Was he really, though?
That's what I understood.
Was he really, though?
That's what I understood, yeah. So, I thought Kidman was awesome, you know what I mean? And you know, and then I followed him when he was in WWE for a bit, you know, he had like the invasion match and stuff, and I was like, oh, this is cool, and it was cool, you know. Got to WWE, I was teaming with Brian, that was good as, I was like, this is awesome, good team with my best friend, everything's great. He had to leave for, you know, he just wasn't, you know, he needed to go clear his head and go do his own thing for a bit and refresh, and that was totally understandable. I was fairly new at the time, so I was like, well, fuck, I'll stick around. So then it just got to a matter of like, oh, well, these guys both have dark hair, and it's kind of short, and like,
they do similar stuff,
kind of flippy stuff, let's put these guys together and see what happens, and, I mean, it was flattering, it was cool, because for me, it was my first taste of success.
No, I hate to cut you off.
No, please.
There was a point where we did a match, and Paul just did a Shooting Star. I think it was against Matt.
It was Matt and Shannon. Yeah, Madison Square Garden,
yeah,
actually.
Yeah,
it was my first
house shows. And, you know, boom, I hit him with a something. I go down to all fours. Paul comes off Shooting Star. This motherfucker, you know, decides to make an issue of all places in Gorilla. And I remember Paul sticking up for himself and saying something about, inventing the headlock. Or, you know, oh, okay.
Well, he goes, hey, man, what, are you going to steal my move? You going to steal my move every night? Or something like that? And he wasn't even doing the Shooting Star anymore, right? And I was like, what did he say?
It was something about the clothesline or the headlock or whatever. But he called them out on his shit, man. He
just,
did.
Yeah, it was just, you know. Because I've always felt like mine was...
You weren't
different.
Trying to fuck the motherfucker, man. Hell no.
I was just trying to do my thing, get myself seen. But, you know, so they eventually teamed us up, and it was what it was. I felt like he wasn't really into it, because I felt like he knew that they weren't really interested in him, and they were just kind of throwing him whatever they could. Whereas with me, it was like, oh, he's new, let's throw him what we can. Or let's throw him this. We're not doing anything with Kidman, let's throw him together. And where I had hoped that it had been kind of more of a mentoring situation, it turned out to be just kind of like more of like good cop, bad cop. Like, that's not even really a real analogy. Just like, we were cool when we was just he and I. We put any of the other boys in the room, and he just buried me or like put himself over my expense.
How common is that, man?
It's so common.
The way personalities change.
Oh, it's
with
disgusting.
The other personalities in the room.
It's disgusting.
You put one other personality in this room, and another personality will change.
It's
you
disgusting.
Take them out of the
yeah.
room, and oh, I'm a nice guy now.
It
it's
sucks.
Fucked. It's
yeah,
fucked.
It sucks.
Yeah, it's fucked.
And I mean, there was a big age difference, you know what I mean? And we didn't talk, you know, outside of matches or anything like that. He's married and this and that. And I got along with Tori, and everything was cool. I mean, and I told him, you know, I never was like, hey, maybe I should do the Shooting Star. Like, it was never an issue. I just, out of respect, I was like, hey, you know, I'll do it whenever I'm allowed to do it. And, but I think I just kind of got fed up with, like, are we a team or what? You know what I mean? Like, are we a team or what? Are you gonna stand up for me or are you gonna throw me into the bus? Make your fucking, pick your side. And I kind of got fed up with it. And even when we started having this feud with the Dudleys,
to me, which was really fascinating because it was your guys I had watched on TV again. And I was like, oh, these guys are a real storied tag team, even though I don't think that's the case anymore.
But still, man, they
but
done
still,
a lot of shit.
Phenomenal.
Yeah.
Yeah,
man.
And they've done all these TLC matches and stuff. I was like, fuck yeah, I get to be in the ring with these guys? Fuck yeah. And so I'd hoped that Kidman would have stood up for me as a tag partner, he just would, he'd save his own ass most often than not. And Bubba had an issue with me for whatever reason. I think he was trying to test me or didn't like this new kid coming in or whatever. And I was trying to hold my own because I wasn't going to let this fucking guy walk over me, you know. I knew better than that. And we had matches at times where he would take his fucking belt off after the show or after the match and just start whipping me without telling me. And shit like that, I just don't think is... Whatever, if you're going to hit me with the belt buckle, you're a fucking faggot if you're going to tell me about that. That's just not cool, in my opinion. When the camera's not even rolling.
No, that's flat out low.
The camera's not even rolling.
Nobody's
fucking matching to take your belt off.
Nobody's
fucking
getting over,
me,
man. Nobody's getting over. That's
they
low.
They put us over, you guys? Are you that big of a fucking bitch? And I just found Bubba to be a real political fucking baby. He's a real pussy. You know what I mean? And there came a point when I stiffed the fuck out of him in a house show up in Canada. And he just fell and fucking flop out on the floor and just laid there. And the whole match changed.
Because that's the way bullies work.
I just hit him
in the face and they're done.
I formed the fuck out of him. And he just flopped over and fell on the floor and just stayed there for the rest of the match. Like, we had just improvised this finish and shit. And it was like, and then afterwards, it was like, hey, where were you, man? Where was the... And he was like, oh, well, I was getting my breath. And I was just like... And then Kidman, he was like, hey, man, you hit me kind of stiff. And that was the one time Pete stood up and was like, oh, maybe he meant to hit you. And he goes, oh, yeah, kid, you think you got your stripes to hit me? And I was like, I don't know. You know, and he's like, oh, we'll see, we'll see. But it's just all talk, you know. D-Von was always cool, but he was just kind of like Bubba's little yes man. And
I think D-Von's cool as fuck.
He's cool
just,
as shit.
He's just floating by.
And Bubba had his moments too, but for the most part, I think he was just bitter, you know, putting up a new group of new guys. And I remember when we won the titles in Winnipeg, Pat Patterson, no, it was Finley. Finley came up to Pete. I'm like, oh, I just saw the Dudleys camping outside of Vince's office for like 20 minutes. We're like, really? He goes, yeah. And I went up to them. I said, what are you guys doing? They said, nothing. And I said, you guys aren't here to change the match? And they were like, no. And so I told them, well, see you then. And they just kind of shrugged their shoulders and walked off. And when Fit told us that, we just thought it was so funny. It was
Fit's all right, man.
Yeah, he's all right.
He's got his moments.
Really? The Dudleys are politicking? Like, and so that was one of my early introductions to politics, just like guys that would camp outside of Vince's office and wait to schmooze him and tell him that they thought this was more productive than what, you know, it's disgusting. And Bubba eventually lightened up when he knew I'd probably fucking murder him if he fucking pushed me. And there was a time when I remember we were in Europe and... Renee was at ends there, and he was kind of like just getting disillusioned with the whole place. He was like, God, is this what we worked for and everything? And we were in Italy.
Is that when he whipped his dick out?
Yeah, it is. And I said, this is a fine dick, even though it has an anteater fucking tip on it.
Does he have one of those?
I think he isn't. Yeah,
we still have
an anteater dick.
You know, I ain't Jewish, but I got that shit clipped.
Why not? Anyways, you know, we were talking, just bullshit on the beach, and being friends, and kind of being there for each other.
About foreskin.
For sure. And we came back to the locker room the next day, and I remember Bubba was sitting there with all the guys, and he was like, I heard you guys had a nice stroll on the beach. Nice romantic walk on the beach. You know, just trying to stir shit. I was like, how old are you, really, man? Come on, this is the best you got? I got high school coaches fucking berated me and yelled at me and got to me and this fucking clown. And it was just like things like that, you know, where you try to make examples out of you and your fucking tag partner wouldn't stand up for you because he's a fucking puss. But I just held my own. I was like, hey, man, two friends walking, like, just didn't do anything. I was just like, hey, whatever. And eventually Taker was like, hey, man, you handled yourself real well in there. I was like, what do you mean? The match? He was like, no, in the locker room, you know, guys trying to push you around and you held your own. That's good. Yeah, it's real good.
Thanks, boss.
And so I started to kind of like get to feel like, oh, okay, this is how this kind of place works, you know, and it was what it was. But as far as teaming with Kidman, and I recently did a show in the Northeast with his nephew.
Bats.
Yeah,
we
Mikey
helped
Bats.
Him get hired. No bullshit.
Mikey Bats.
We got him hired. Good dude.
We got him hired for the junior division. Because they thought he was a midget.
To work with Super Porky. And,
yeah. Octagon Tito and shit. But he ref one of the matches recently, and he was like, "Hey man, I heard you didn't like Kidman, and Pete thought you all that." I was like, "Well, he was a dick. He threw me under the bus. You know, he was a fucking. He wasn't there. He was more for me, less than he was there for me. Mm-hmm. And so you know, it is what it is. I don't have any feelings against him now. You know, I'm not the one that got caught banging some pig when I was dating Tori. You know, whatever. It's not my issue." None of it is. Whatever. I just go where my dick leads me.
That's no good either, man.
Oh, shit!
No. No, I don't. I don't have a dick. I'm cut it off, actually. Yeah. I'm like a Ken doll.
You know, that's a good idea.
I have a stub.
Honestly,
I have a stub.
Yourself.
I actually do. When a girl wants to get fucked, I attach one. It's kind of like a rocket cock.
This motherfucker. Hey, let's go put matches together. We go downstairs. This motherfucker is hanging out with the girls for 45 minutes straight.
That's not
see girl. Which one of these he can fuck.
What? Come on.
I might say, well.
No.
Yeah, but he was most with the girls for 45 minutes straight.
Very easy.
Nice girl. Everybody's nice here.
Yeah. Except the ones that take steroids. They have very big clits. It's disgusting.
Is that so bad?
I don't know. I think you work with them, with some of them now.
Big clits.
Some of the big clits.
Yeah, I think you work with the big clit.
Big clits.
The BCC.
What do you got for us?
Big
clits. Besides big clits.
Paul referenced what you're doing now. Experiences at TNA so far?
I gotta take another piss.
Go for it. I'll talk about
big
TNA.
Big clit talk.
While you're peeing.
What was the question? Experiences at TNA so far?
Talk about TNA.
Honestly, it's been great, man. I did my first week there. I had a 3-month sort of deal, and I worked on the pay per view. I was very satisfied with it, but then they did 4 weeks of tapings, and I was on 1 out of 4, and I complained about it, and you know, shit got explained to me that you're gonna be on the next 2 pay-per-views and blah blah blah. What I like about them, Terry's been real honest with me. I get to work, even if I don't get the professional satisfaction, let's say, from working a 3-minute match on an Impact. Well, fuck, on February 27th, I get to work Lee Valiant for as long as I want. For in the exact style of match that I want, that he wants. I, the difference between working there and anywhere, well, not anywhere, but WWE, is that I'm there for a week, and then if that doesn't satisfy me, I can go to PWG, I can go to ROH, I can go to Dragon Gate, and I can get what I want out of wrestling.
What is it that you want out of wrestling?
What I really like to do is I really, really, really like to take the X division, which is just seen as car crash guys. With my first match at TNA, not first match, but my first match back, I worked right on the pay-per-view, and we had an agent who came up to us and said, "Okay, guys, video game car crash." And I said, I'm not a video game wrestler." "Oh, well, I'm not talking about you." "Well, of course you're talking about me. You're talking about both of us." But I was able to wrestle the style that I wanted. And every week, I've been able to put my foot down, and they've accepted it. I've been able to put my word in. They put their 2 cents in, and we go back and forth. But I feel like I get more out of wrestling here in TNA, perspective-wise, what I want out of it than I did before. That's the difference, yeah.
Paul, what do you want out of wrestling?
Lavish pussies.
Vaginas.
Yeah.
know,
we're trying to open up a school in L.A.
Yeah, we've been trying to, you know,
I feel like a lot of things get lost, like, fundamentally, as far as, like, just different things. It would be a neat project to try and open a school and see what could come of it, you know, and see what kids are really committed to trying to commit their lives, or at least that first part of their lives to getting to wrestling. Something like that would be interesting. I don't know, as far as wrestling, it's weird, you know, because when I got into wrestling, there were so many challenges that I set up for myself, and I feel like I kind of accomplished most of them as far as just, like, getting WWE.
How easy was that? I remember we talked about that.
Yeah, I mean, it was easier than I foresaw.
Peculiarly easy.
It was easy. We had just this nonstop attitude of, this isn't going to stop till we get there, you know? And so, you know, within 3 years, we were there. But, I don't know, man. Like, you know, I'm a monkey in the sense that I was born in that year, Chinese year of the monkey. And
I'm
a lamb. So
I'm a sheep.
Are you?
I'm a sheep.
I get bored easily, and I like to have all sorts of challenges. And so with wrestling, it's not that the challenge is gone, but it is to an extent. It's like I got to WWE, and nobody thought I would ever, not even my own family. And I did better than most people probably thought I was ever going to make. And so I'm happy with what I've done. If I never wrestle another match, I'll be fine. It's more about self-discovery now and finding what can I grow from. And I just feel like the ability to grow in wrestling is quite limited for me right now. There's just so much that I'm just not interested in anymore, you know? It's once you've had a hamburger every day for 365 days in a row, you're kind of looking for something else to eat, you know? So, you know, I'm taking my hand to something else and going after a second dream, and to me it's a lot more challenging, and we'll see. But I think that your life should be about growth and prosperity and about, kind of, you know, trying to continue elevation, you know, just seeking that enlightenment, I guess, if that's what the journey is. But just trying to develop my awareness as broad as possible and just trying to, I guess, get to that path of enlightenment. But I feel like I had one dream down, and now it's on to another one, really.
You fucking done did it, man.
Yeah, you know what I mean?
No,
I never
Paul,
set out
Paul,
to be a world
an
champion.
I'm with you.
And so I'm kind of looking to move on to something else. So I'm very fortunate to have wrestling, because it pays for my bills, and it's afforded me a tremendous amount of opportunities. I've made a million friends, it feels like, even though I don't keep in touch with any of them except this guy. And
you know what, though?
That's not true. Yeah,
you know what, though? There's nothing wrong with that. The way wrestling works, it's just the way it works.
Let's keep in touch, man.
You're best friends with 8 years ago. 8 years later, you see him, and it's just like old times.
Yeah.
Wrestling's very odd like that.
I haven't spoken to Jimmy Yang in probably over a year and a half.
Yeah, but when you see him, you'll give him a big fucking... a super hug. You know, you went out with two. Yeah,
we
hit
right off again. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? We'll be tax sisters together.
He'd get us in jail by the end of the night.
Yeah.
He probably would. Fucking hillbilly.
Hillbilly slope.
K-fabe slope.
That's it. Yeah, K-fabe slope.
Talk about bad breath.
You know, Regal would fucking kill me about that.
Regal pulled Brian aside one time specifically
to
tell him.
And Regal
breath.
And I are boys, but Jimmy and I were buddies, and
Regal knew that, so he knew that he could tell Brian, like, his fucking breath.
And Regal
was fucking unbearable.
And Regal would talk about his own breath, because he'd take garlic pills. Like, I know my breath's bad, but this guy's fucking breath.
It's a hygiene thing. I just don't understand it.
I never smelled it.
I did.
I'm sure it's
Jimmy dipped it.
It's kimchi. Oh, dipped?
Yeah, he dipped it.
Oh, I mooched up many a dips off of Jimmy.
I've never dipped.
I have. I've done it all. It's shameful.
You know, I think we have a lot of pride. We take a lot of pride in a lot of things, though, too. You know, like, something a lot of people may not take knowledge of is that, you know, neither of us have ever taken any form of a steroid. Ever.
The one promise I made to my mom before I went to wrestling, she said, please don't take any steroids. You got it, Mom.
Simple as
that. That's it. I haven't done it. You know,
I never once considered it.
Surprise, surprise. Yeah. But
and then just, you know, some people go certain paths and guys go other paths. And
I think, you know, I can't speak for Brian, but I know that, like, I did enough research as I was getting into wrestling, trying to absorb as much as possible. I saw how many pitfalls guys fell into.
Baseball slide.
Oh, yeah.
Trap.
All sorts of things. And then when I got into wrestling, I started to see guys abuse it. I could see how, you know, just ineffective they were. Like, I remember Carlito, he gassed up real bad one time and then took a hair beel. Like a bitch beel from Bob Holly one time and tore his whole pec and all this shit. And it was like, just because he was puffed up. And, you know, it's just like, what's the benefit for me? It was like, I got this far without it. Why do I need it now?
There's zero benefit to it.
And so that was something, that was another thing I took a lot of pride in.
At least ecstasy makes you feel good. You know what I mean? Oh. You can take other drugs to make you like, hey, this is a good time, man.
Acid creates synapses.
Yeah, or I can take this and tear my muscles.
Yeah exactly.
Okay.
Yeah,
that
so,
like,
you know,
fun.
Just never seemed any point to do steroids. Just, why bother? We got this far without them. Why start now? So, and the fact that we never, ever, ever did. I don't even think I could possibly ever inject myself. You know, needles make me laugh. Mm. They tickle, but I just never could never do that to my. I don't think I would miss the vein. I don't even know how the fuck that would work.
No, don't do it.
You know what I mean? I just wouldn't bother. Plus, there's a tremendous amount of life after wrestling, you know, in my opinion. And I see too many guys in wheelchairs and dying young and all this bullshit. And so, you know, if you really care about a career in wrestling, then, you know, take the necessary precautions. And if that matters to you, you'll do your homework and.
Eat your vitamins, say your prayers.
Say your prayers, drink your
milk or whatever the fuck it is.
Milk.
You'll be alright.
Oh. Vince McMahon.
What about him?
Next up.
Memories, initial impressions, how he changed over time. Just impressions overall.
Oh shit. I mean, my interaction with him was very limited. You know what, there was times where I'd have to fucking go wait and talk to him and he gave me the time. I had to fucking take it, but he gave it to me, and ultimately, he's the fucking boss, man. I'm just a pawn.
Yeah, it sucks. I mean, he's the ultimate. He's the voice, you know, and it's like, nobody dares cross this guy, who doesn't seem to have a really good grasp on his audience. He's pretty, you know, he's stuck in time. He doesn't, he's very close-minded, not really willing to collaborate with anybody except his, like, little group. I never once felt that he was interested in the fact that I was even standing in front of him. Like, it was just a waste of time. Mm. The one time that I can remember thinking, like, does this guy not hate me right now? Or is this guy not, like, is he trying to lighten up to me? Or, like, was when I had my beard. And we were sitting, in Gorilla because we were the opening match on Raw. And so we're sitting there in the Gorilla waiting for, you know, Pyro's going off and all this stuff. And he's coming to sit down in Gorilla's, put his headphones on and all that stuff. And he comes up to me. I think Brian was at the bottom of the stairs warming up or something. And because we had a couple seconds. Yeah, and so he comes up, he's walking past me. And he's like, hey, I like the beard. What's with your partner? And I was like, I don't think he's gone through puberty yet.
I can't grow him.
Yeah, and he was like, he's just phony.
Oh,
laugh.
I'll try to remember your names.
Yeah, I was like, oh, thanks, oh, great one, for giving me your time of day. It was like,
it'll be twice as healthy next week.
Bow down to no man, and I don't fear any fucking human being, you know? It's just like, he's just another fucking guy. And I think I just got really disgusted by seeing all these people just lay down and give up all their power to this guy who was just a rotten person. He just seemed like a nasty human being. And
he's been real successful, man. I mean, and he created something that I love.
Yeah.
You know, he really did. And for me to think, like, oh, Ultimate Warrior, and, like, this motherfucker is twice the size that I am. And that's what made me want to be a wrestler. You know, when I was delusional, fuck it, I'll be just as intense. And, you know, I got as far as I did. And fuck, I mean, I'm happy I did. You know, I don't want to spend another day in WWE. And that's the truth. And there's no dollar amount for my happiness. I've done it before for dirt cheap, and I'm not going to do it again for any amount of money. But I'm not going to say I was, you know, it's all his fault. No, man. I knew I was smoking weed, you know, but I tried to fight it. You know, I knew I was a pain in the ass. I knew I fucking stuck up for myself, but I didn't give a shit, you know? And I was going to stick up for myself till I got fired, and they got me. I got fired, you know? I don't regret it. I was shocked. I was upset. It was hard to explain to my wife, but fuck, man, I'm glad it's done. And I ain't going back, man. I'd rather go work at Home Depot or fucking anywhere, man.
Really? You don't enjoy the Kiss My Ass Club?
Even for like a million. Your ass club?
Yeah. It's oil and water.
What's flipped the team up between you guys? There were a lot of rumors at the time that Brian, you wanted to go single.
Mm-hmm.
Did you want to address that at all, or what split the team up?
What ultimately did it for me was the meeting with Shane, and we've been going nowhere. And after that, we knew we were fucked.
It's like spinning wheels, man.
It was spinning wheels. Yeah, there's no way. Like there wasn't anywhere for us to go. I'm proud of what we did. I think Paul compliments me. I compliment him. I think we're perfect for each other in that respect. And they don't like tag teams or whatever the fuck. But they sure don't like guys that aren't what they want to be. And that's what it is.
Marionettes that can walk on their own don't belong in the land of We Were Entertaining. Because it's just, they want to control everything. I mean, it's like Rumpelstiltskin, man. He has to have first dibs on everything you do. I mean, it's right on top of you. They control everything.
We couldn't be the Hooligans.
We tried forever to get this name.
Forever. We had the shit on our gear. We couldn't be the Hooligans because...
Oh, I don't want... you don't need a tag team. Why do you guys need a tag team name? That way, when we split you up, we'll be able to just keep you guys as is.
Yeah, nobody know who you were if you were the Hooligans when we split you up. Nobody knows who the fuck we are now, man. You don't know who the fuck we are now.
It was just a bunch of lip service, you know? It was just...
What can you do? Mm-hmm.
So just do the best of what you have control over, which is very little. And turn your power over to a company like that. And fascist like him, who just doesn't want to listen to anybody. And anybody that disagrees with him or tries to offer an alternate opinion is fired or, you know, in the doghouse. It's just like...
That match we had against the Bucks, man, I was so happy about.
Yeah, that was cool.
Real happy about it.
I mean, it was sour, though. It was like, just... At least they could have done something, you know, like this split, but just didn't care.
They didn't give a fuck.
You mentioned the match you just had with the Young Bucks.
Mm-hmm.
Compare and contrast wrestling at WWE with wrestling at, say, Pro Wrestling Guerrilla.
I was in shape when I wrestled in WWE. I wasn't really in shape.
The difference was, like with the Bucks. You know, we have a little bit of a promo bullshit, blah, blah, blah. We have our match. We have some stuff, and I don't like to have a lot of, like, this, then this. Just, we'll do this until that. And we were going to wrestle around, and I saw them fucking smiling like jerk-offs on the apron. And fuck it, I'm just going to beat their ass. And it just turned into a brawl. And for kids that are 20 and 23, 24, I don't know, they're young, though. And we didn't tell them, we just fucking got on them. And they flipped the script like we wanted them to. That's nice. And you can't do that when you've got 5 minutes. We've got a show to produce. This isn't about you. It's about our show. Which it is about their show. But in the indies, we can fucking do our match. And fuck, it's just so much more satisfying. I was really happy afterwards, for sure.
Whereas, like, on the, you know, the entertainers, it's like, well, we got this supporting cast, but it's really about this essential star piece right here. Whereas in the independents, it's like, well, we're proud of all these guys. Let's just go out there and give the best show from top to bottom and make sure the fans are happy. Whereas I think the entertainers like to claim, like, let's make the fans happy. But in truth, it's like, well, let's make as much money as we can. And I get that philosophy. It's a business, but I just think that they don't know their audience as well as they think they know their audience. And I think that, you know, I believe that most of their ideas that they try to come up with creatively are, you know, like maybe 4 months too old. I mean, it's just so, I mean, if you look at the entertainers, I mean, they really are a black eye in the entertainment business as far as like Hollywood and stuff. And they're kind of like a bastard child. Like Vince wants so hard to get into Hollywood, but Hollywood's kind of, you know, they just kind of laugh at it, you know? It's,
he's doing pretty good for what was a circus act.
True. True.
I mean,
he's trying to get his, he's in the business to create stars.
Nobody's done with wrestling what he's done with wrestling. He's trying to legitimize it.
Sure.
Is it still goofy? Are the movies bad? Are there guys in the movies that I like that I can't even fucking watch? Sure, yeah, they're bad movies. But yeah, I mean, he's trying. He might think we're cocksuckers, and we might think he's a cocksucker, but...
I'll be happy when he's dead. I'll say that. When he dies, I think there'll be rainbows all over the place. Lucky charms falling in our hands.
Have you had chocolate Lucky Charms?
Really?
What's your favorite cereal of all time?
Oh, fuck, man. I don't know.
Have you ever had Ninja Turtle cereal? Do you remember that?
Probably. I think so.
Does anybody remember that? Remember. Okay, with the frosted nets and the... Okay.
Oh, I don't know.
Best cereal of all time.
Really?
Yeah.
I like Cookie Crisp, but that's kind of...
Imagine Chex that were frosted and then add marshmallows.
Pretty sweet.
Yeah, that's Ninja Turtle Sugar cereal.
What's like Cinnamon Toast?
Oh, Cinnamon Toast Golden Crunch.
Graham.
Yeah, and they make with like a third less sugar versions now, but
I don't eat cereal too much anymore.
I love it. You don't drink milk.
My metabolism is not the way it used to be.
He's not a milk drinker.
Not too much. Unless it's out of a teat.
Huh? Isn't that more interesting than
milk.
He's not a milk drinker.
I might drink tit milk if it was presented. Rene Dupree, a friend of mine, used to milk himself.
Yeah.
I should say anything.
Yeah.
I won't say what kind of substances were in his body, but they were creating milk. Producing lactated. I don't know. I don't inject myself with things, but...
You know, he used to have gap teeth until he
wrestled
in Cincinnati.
Yeah.
And then him and I wrestled a match where he had to call in the ring.
I
moved in the corner, and he took the pole and busted his teeth.
Oh.
And now he's got perfect
teeth.
He's got two brand new teeth.
So all you French
Tickler
fans out
Rene
there,
Dupree.
You have this man to thank for the perfect teeth that French Tickler had.
Like a gap, like, as wide as my pinky.
Rene's awesome.
He's
was another one of my really good
like
friends
him,
who
yeah.
I rode with for a long time. And
you puked in his bathtub.
Oh, my
Your
God,
mother's.
Yeah. I ruined his bathtub at WrestleMania one time. I had all these sweet potato French fries. We were doing the video game challenge at WrestleMania. They were like, we need some, put London in there. And I was like, oh, cool. And I made it to the semis and like beat all these top stars. They were like, ugh. And then I think I lost to Shelton, who's just like a big video game nerd.
Yeah.
And so they took us up to the restaurant. I think it was a House of Blues in Chicago. And it was like, open bar. Hooray! There's like steak and all this sweet potato fries. And like, I ended up throwing up in Rene's bathtub. And he must have, I mean, honestly, like a foot, like up to this beer box. Just a layer in his bathtub of orange, like, film. He was taking video of me, and I was like flexing and like throwing up at the same time and laughing. It was retarded.
Is that where we got the 3-pack?
But he had to switch his room altogether because he couldn't drain his bathtub. It was like too clogged.
Did we get the 3-pack in Chicago with Jimmy?
The 3-pack? I don't know the 3-pack.
The 3-pack action figures with Jimmy Yang.
Oh. I don't know.
For Smoking Out?
Maybe. I don't know.
Yeah. Okay, anyways. What do you got next?
I forget a lot. Are we still haven't found any weed?
What is this? Well, you just mentioned Rene Dupree. Anyone else a name we haven't mentioned yet that really made a big impression on you or that you had a lot of good times with that we just haven't mentioned yet?
My father.
Yeah.
No, I don't know.
Jimmy Yang.
Super crazy.
Super crazy. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I was even friends with Carlito for a little bit before he became a superstar in his own mind. And so, you know, at OVW, people in OVW are like a certain kind of friends. And then, like, once people get moved to TV, they either stay the same or change completely. It's where you don't recognize them or you don't want to recognize them anymore. And she's like, nah, I used to know that guy, but I'm kind of glad I don't anymore. That's just the atmosphere that it creates.
Look, I realize I'm a piece of shit in some ways. Everybody is. So, sure, we all are. And so, you know, I try to accept them all. So yeah, I like everybody for the most part.
It's a cast of characters, man.
Yeah, I don't know what to say other than Santino's the fucking funniest motherfucker Santino's on the entire hilarious. Planet. I've been trying to get him in movies, man, with my buddy Brad.
Those porn ass?
Oh, no. Oh. He's the funniest motherfucker on the planet. Other than that, I mean, really?
Santino is hilarious.
Yeah, humans are humans. You get along with them, you know, unless you're a dick. Santino, though, is the funniest motherfucker on the planet, yeah.
I think there's a lot.
That I know. I'm sure there is. I'm sure there's funnier. You know?
No, he's really
funny. I'm sure Bill Cosby's funnier, but not to me.
Yeah.
Oh, fuck. That goofy Canadian prick.
He likes pudding. Bill Cosby.
Yeah, he does. They both love pudding.
Hey, that magic pen. I always wanted to write with that thing. Where that magic? What was that magic? What was that show he had? Bill Cosby?
The Cosby Show?
Picture Page. Remember that shit? He'd write that magic pen. It was like...
You remember when Santino fucked up on the pull the rope, backdrop me over? Oh, and I wanted to kill him, but I like him too much.
Like, Santino's a guy you love the guy. He's a great guy. I mean, even no matter how lousy he might be in the ring, you know, but he knows he's not like spectacular.
The fuck. I love him to death. I want to wrestle him every day.
Yeah.
What do you got for us?
Have the Brian Kendrick come about on SmackDown.
I'll take a quick pitch break. Don't take a piss there. Okay.
I pitched my shit to the boss. Then it came time to debut it. I had brand new gear and I had my old gear. I went to Michael Hayes. I had my promo written up, but you know, memorized. Here's what I want to say. He had his own promo for me. I wanted to use my new gear. He said, "Well, we want to break you into it." I said, "Well, let me put on my gear." I went and I put on my gear. I came back. Luckily, Hunter was in the room when I came back, and I had the jacket my wife made, my brand new gear, and Hunter popped for it. And so Hayes said, "Well, fuck, ask Vince." So went to Vince, and Vince goes, "Well, what the fuck do I care?" So that was an okay for me. I went to Hayes. He said the gear's good. I had my promo. He didn't like my promo. He rearranged it. I went to the boss. I gave the promo that Michael Hayes gave me. He shit on it. And he goes, "You write that?" I said, "No. You know, I have my own promo, but this is Hayes helped me out. Well, give me your promo." I gave my promo. And he goes, "That's perfect. But from now on, you're the Brian Kendrick." So as far as, like, the character, everything else, I guess I can take credit for myself, I don't know, but the was Vince's idea, ultimately. I cut my promo, "You're the Brian Kendrick," so, and I do love it, I thought it was cool. He owns it now, it's gone, but yeah, that was his idea.
How did the partnership with Ezekiel Jackson come about?
When I pitched the idea, my argument was, what happened was, I was working a singles match. We're on different rosters now, Paul and I are. I'm working a match against Dolph Ziggler. And I think he's really talented. And Rob Terry, I'm not sure what his name was then, but he's in TNA now as Rob Terry, was his valet. We have a heat spot. I'm in the corner. I give Ziggler the boot. The ref goes with Ziggler. Rob Terry pulls my foot. He doesn't pull my foot. I'm waiting. He doesn't pull my foot. I'm waiting. I come out. I clothesline Ziggler. I look at Terry and he's like posing to the crowd. I'm fucking livid. I get on him. The referee says, change the finish. We put Ziggler over. But as we're putting him over, the ref says, kick out. We change it again. So after the match, I'm so fucking pissed. I go through Gorilla. I shoulder tackle Ricky Steamboat, who I love, man. I love Ricky Steamboat. Unintentional. I'm ready to fucking quit. I go outside. I'm screaming. I got a temper problem. That's, yeah, whatever. I come back. Arn Anderson pulls me aside. Starts trying to calm me down. No, fuck this. Fuck that. I'm pissed off. You know, if I can do this shit with this cocksucker, what can I do with Hunter? He says, okay, well, we'll talk with Michael Hayes. Michael Hayes pulls me aside, tries to calm me down. Well, you know, this, that, and the other. No, motherfucker. You're the one who made me put Deuce over. You're the motherfucker who made me wrestle three-minute matches against cocksuckers. You're the one who made me wrestle Gemini and put him over. So I was livid, man. Johnny Hayes pulls me aside. We're going to talk to Vince. We're going to talk to Vince. Okay, we're going to wait outside his office. Johnny Ace sees me waiting outside of Vince's office and walks away, disappears. So I'm stuck there by myself. And when he came, can I talk to you? Sure, in a minute. He does his shit, comes back out, opens up the door, what do you want to say? And I fucking spill my guts, man. I'm ready to quit. If I can make this piece of shit look good, how can I make your top guys look? If I can make this piece of garbage look, how can I make Shawn Michaels, Umaga, Triple H look? And he was with me. But then ultimately, I didn't satisfy what he wanted. You know, I pushed for what I wanted. And Johnny Ace said he liked it. Oh, you know, I was doing great. I got fired, and ultimately, I just didn't get it.
Fuck that skateboard, bag it.
And you know, I bitch and complained. I said it made Jerry Lawler look like he knew how to wrestle still. Well, yeah, well, I can help you get to Japan. Johnny, I don't need your fucking help getting to Japan. But it's just, he's got a job to do. I got a job to do. It's a company.
I could outskate that motherfucker. Easily. I could already eat pizza.
You remember when Mark Henry called me out for getting hurt from skateboarding?
Did he?
I tried skateboard for the first time at like 27, like a schmuck. I hurt myself. I had to wrap myself up. And I hurt myself training. I don't think you did. Yeah, Mark Henry caught on to me. Anyways.
Really?
Yeah. I like him.
Takes an injury prone guy to know what an injury is.
He threw my bachelor party.
Really?
When I was on the road and I was going to get married, he went around and got everybody and threw, you know what, they didn't, it was like pasties, and it, like, so I didn't even see nipples, but still, Mark had entered my bachelor party,
apparently Mark Henry would like read full layout porn, like Hustler and shit on an airplane. Like out of a packed airplane, he'll just be like,
yeah. A film master.
Yeah.
I
like Mark.
I do too, man. I really do.
He's like a basketball.
And he's a barbecue fan.
He is.
What's
his
favorite?
He's a Longhorn.
Rudy's?
He's just Texas Longhorn.
No, what was the commercial?
Oh, Rudy's? He's a Rudy's barbecue spokesman. Yeah.
How do you guys think Brian Danielson would do there?
Who?
I'm gonna give you.
You mean Daniel Bryan?
I'm gonna give you a story before I take a piss. They stuck me with an angle, where I had to cut a promo. I'm gonna bring in my new tag team partner. When I went to go cut the promo, they cut the mic on me, and I was fucking pissed. Yeah. So I had no promo. I'm yelling shit and screaming at Jerry Lawler and Jim Ross and. And they're looking at me and doing this. And I'm fucking livid. So, you know, I pull the writers aside. So you get to do it next week. I'm going to bring in the perfect tag team partner. At this point, I already talked to him. Bryan Danielson. That's who I'm bringing in. Bryan Danielson's going to be my tag team partner. To the writers, they love it. But Johnny Ace is saying, well, yeah, we'll bring him in, but you got to talk to Bryan the writer. Bryan the writer is as far away as you are from I. Now, I go and talk to Bryan and say, hey, can we bring him in to San Jose? Sure, just talk to Johnny. I go over to Johnny. They fucking disappeared. This motherfucker was supposed to be my goddamn tag team partner, and these cocksuckers were too chicken shit to talk to each other.
Well, it's a coward, man.
It's a bunch of cowards. Bryan Danielson's, he's amazing, man. He's awesome. I think he's, well, I don't know if he'll do good, but
he's good. He's a smart guy. He's a good minded guy. And he's a positive guy. So I don't, I think he's giving himself he's all the reason guy, and all the abilities to do really successful there. And I hope he does, you know. I mean, he's pretty much done everything else. And I know just in talking with him that he's like, I never want to go to TNA. It's so bad. You know, so I told him, I said, don't ever take what we say as, you know, how it is. You should go and judge it for yourself and do the best you can and try to leave your mark, you know, because he's that good that he should be able to leave his mark. So only time will tell if he can endure the cocksuckability of the entertainers.
Tell us about the hybrid dolphins.
Oh, God. You know, it's a fun thing with PWG. To me, it was like a real outlet to just kind of be like, do whatever. You know, there's no limit on it. So it's a real refreshing atmosphere for me, coming from extreme limitations to no limitations. And I think they were receptive because when I came back, I think almost a year ago to the Indies, it was like written consent or something like that, right?
Yeah.
And they were just so, it was so nice and genuinely.
Mine broke, but I found this one in the bathroom. So
you really?
This one.
It might have been yours.
Yeah, it probably is because I picked at it.
But you were saying earlier, like, how does it feel to be a guy that the company's restructuring, you know, they're focusing on you? And I was like, well, I never felt that way, but what they did with PWG. And it was really refreshing to go from, oh, you're bottom feeder, I don't really care about you, to like, hey, thanks
stroke
for being
my
here.
Ego,
oh, yeah. Wow, it's so nice. It's just to feel appreciative, and I mean, it's an emotional thing when you put everything you have into it and the fans respond. So, you know, just being able to work with no limitations is really refreshing, especially, you know, PWG, because they're always willing to push shit and do weird, outrageous shit. It's a unique company. I think that's what I dig about it. And so that just happened to be, you know, that day I'd been at the beach and I actually had some pizza. I was in Malibu.
You talking about when we worked the Bucks?
No, he's asking about how the hybrid dolphin thing came about.
Oh,
okay. And so I was having some pizza from Damores in Malibu, and I was sitting at this spot that I like to chill out at all the time. I get to watch dolphins mingle and animals and different sea mammals play. And I don't know. You know, every day is just kind of a new day of discovery. You just kind of see what it brings. And I try not to think too far in advance in my life, because I feel that when you make so many plans, it's like planning out your wrestling match. It's like, well, if something goes haywire, it might throw off your whole string of events. And so I try not to think too far in advance. I like to just kind of enjoy the moments I'm in. And so I go to the beach a lot, you know, especially now that I live in L.A. And I went to PWG that night after I hung out at the beach and just kind of meditated for a bit. And then I had a lousy match that I was really disappointed about. It's just like, man, that was not good up to my standards. And I was ready to go home, and they came and dragged me out of the parking lot, and they said, we still need you to do this promo. I'm like, really? I don't know, I'm seeing all sorts of aliens and stuff now. Like, I don't know what was in the atmosphere here in Los Angeles, but it smells like Christmas. And but I love it.
And said, "Well, you and Brian are going to do this tag team thing." I was like, "I have no idea." And being an expert at improv, I was just like, "What do you want us to do? Well, all right, let's go with it." And we had this tag match set up with Brian and Scott Lawson. At the point, I thought I was going to be able to work the match. Turned out not to be. But anyways, we just had fun. Just rapped about all the intergalactic gifts that are given to us on a daily basis. And Brian was quite the improv-y. Responded quite well, and I didn't even know they put the promo up. And they're like, "Oh, your promo's up," and it's already got like all these hits on YouTube. I was like, "What promo?" The dolphin one. They loved it. I'm like, "Really? I didn't even remember that." And I don't know. It's weird. The weirdest shit takes off sometimes. But I do love The Island of Dr. Moreau. It's a great film.
Yeah. Yeah. Any parting thoughts?
Best is yet to come. Yeah, thanks for everything.
Best it's been a real slice.
Yeah.
This is just
any parting questions?
I mean, this is
And looking by the clock, like 0 minutes have gone by. It's still 11:50.
Well, we're in a time warp.
Still in your head.
We might even be in a warm
dude, and we didn't even get into what I wanted to talk about. Yeah.
There's still time. I mean, this is a wormhole. I think we could just talk all night about all sorts of nonsense.
Yeah, well, as long as we got beer, yeah.
That's true. Imagine what we could do with something this color.
I asked earlier, but we'll close with this. Sum up your experiences in wrestling in one or two lines.
Oh, so you're asking if 9/11 was a work.
That's what you wanted to talk about.
Yeah. No,
what
I think is that it was holograms. They use the no black boxes. And then you got Jesse Ventura, who's on TV. Oh, well, you know, the black boxes, you know, blah, blah, blah. It's misinformation. Holograms. Richard C. Hoagland, look it up. Holograms. Boom! I'm going to crash into this building right here. And it's going to take 2 hours. And this part will fall at the same time this part falls. Man, it was fucking holograms. Thank you for asking.
Thanks, guys.
Mm-hmm.
Holograms. I agree.
Thank you. Richard C. Hoagland.